Let's do the damn thing.
Time, so let's take it to the Birdland. That Baltimore home flavor is coming firsthand. Fred, Scott, and Ryan, tell them the word, man. Mixing a little BS to make it work, man. Sports, they got it. Want excitement? The topic. Make sure when they toss you the ball, you don't drop it. With all that swag, you're gonna listen regardless. Here comes the pitch, so it's time to get it started. It's Birdland BS.
BS.
What's up, BSers? Fred, Scott, Brian, James in the studio today, and we got special guest NFL player agent Jobeth Bowers joining us again in the studio. Appreciate you being here, man.
Hey, thanks for having me back.
Yeah.
You, always good to be here.
Took a fun little trip down south for some college football, the only college football that we've seen yet, so we're going to talk a little bit about that.
I have been to all of the games this year.
You have.
Every single one.
You have. I am extremely jealous.
That's impressive. It's very impressive.
So we got a lot to talk about on this week's show, as always. Jeff Zriebeck, one of the writers for The Athletic, wrote a great article, came out today, about the good, bad, and ugly of Ravens training camp thus far. And I think there's a lot in there to digest and a lot in there that we can talk about. So we're going to talk a little bit about that. And we're making bets. We're making bets with some upcoming Ravens stats for the 2020 season. Looking at Lamar, looking at Hollywood, looking at Andrews. We're going to make some bets here live on the air. See what we think is going
to
happen.
You're
willing
to put your
season.
Money where your mouth is?
I'm willing to put my money where my mouth is.
I'm going to double mine.
We'll talk about that a little bit later, too. Ryan Mountcastle, we talked about it last week, made his major league debut. He hits his first two major league home runs. Just so happened to be it was in a minor league stadium. I don't know.
Still impressive.
Still impressive.
Still nice.
But his first two major league home runs are in a minor league stadium. We'll talk a little bit about that. And we got a lot of news in this week's rundown. Some sad news. A local legend, John Thompson, passed away the other day. So we're going to talk a little bit about that and a few other topics. But before we get into too much, we do want to remind you, if you've ever been injured at work or in an auto accident and weren't sure who to call, 855-MD-CRASH, the Maryland personal injury attorneys that'll have your back. If you find yourself in that unfortunate situation, and I know I have, give our team at MD Crash a call right away. We all know the cost of medical bills, lost wages, and pain and suffering. It all can add up quickly and potentially put you in a bad financial place. Well, if you want a team that will handle your case, big or small, and just give you some peace of mind, save this number now. 855-MD-CRASH. That's 855-632-7274. Be sure to follow them on Facebook for some fun giveaways, including gift cards to some local restaurants. Time for some football talk, obviously dominated by Ravens, but with our special guest Jobeth here today, we're going to talk a little bit about college football today as well.
Yes.
But a lot going on as we kind of wrap things up and we get closer to the regular season starting for the Ravens. We're now, what, a little over a week away?
About a little over 10 days. I think we're right around 10 days is where we're at.
Little over a week away before NFL football. Well, I guess the first game is next Thursday.
Right. Yeah,
right?
So that's when NFL starts.
Literally a little over a week away before the NFL is back on the market, unless something, God forbid, knock on wood, happens between now and then. Let's not.
In your words, don't you put that on me, Ricky Bobby.
I know, right? Well, the Ravens are in an interesting spot right now, and I know one of the big stories that's been going around is obviously after Earl Thomas departed, right, that freed up a little bit of temporary cap space on top of the cap space that the Ravens already had, right?
Right.
The Ravens, every year, they like to have a little bit of cap space in reserve going into the off or going into the season, just in case, God forbid, there's an injury and they need some, you know, to sign somebody in the offseason or sign somebody for like free agency wise.
Right. We've seen DaCosta last year put that to the test and really make it work.
Right. It's a security blanket. That's how they were able to go out and get all the linebacking help that they got last year, which really solidified the defense. So they like to do that. But when you look at the numbers that they've got right now, they've got about $13 million total in cap space right now, factoring in the money that was freed up temporarily for the Earl Thomas situation. $13 million is a decent amount of money. The Ravens usually like to have somewhere in the neighborhood of about $5 million going into a year. That's usually their comfort zone, right?
Yeah.
So with Earl Thomas going, there were a lot of rumors out there about cornerback Logan Ryan and the interest in him coming in and filling in and potentially just adding to this
more depth.
I mean, this ridiculous secondary that we have, and then kind of helping out. He's not a safety. He's a corner.
Right.
But being able to help maybe Jimmy transition to safety and add a little bit more depth at cornerback. But Logan Ryan ends up signing with the Giants, right? So the other name out there, and I said this last week, I said, if you're going to fix the back end of a defense without addressing the back end of the defense, the way you do that is you get to the quarterback quicker, right? And a guy that's been out there, and he's been out there all offseason, Jadeveon Clowney, is a guy that there's been many rumors out there that the Ravens are tied to and have been said to be front runners to sign Jadeveon Clowney. What's your take on the potential of bringing him in?
I mean, do I want him? Yeah, I'd love to have him, but what it's going to cost us, I mean, I don't know right now, right? The one thing that's going in our favor is nobody else assigned him either.
Right.
Right? So, obviously, if he wants to play this year, he's going to have to accept a contract that is in probably in all reality lower than what he feels he's worth. And to an extent, what the market says he's worth.
Right.
The one thing that everybody's forgetting and kind of, you know, everybody's hyped on him, the guy had 3 sacks last year. Now, granted, he wasn't in the strongest defense in the world, but he made that team better.
Right.
But what I would say is, can you imagine if he came in on this defensive front that we have now?
That's exactly where I was going with it.
If you can sign him, you know, his worth is our cap space potentially more.
Right.
He's obviously not getting signed for that anywhere. Or if his teams only have 10, 13, 15 million dollars and he's asking for 18, well, then that's his own damn fault.
Right.
But could we take and offer him 9? I'd be willing to potentially do that, because the other thing that allows you to do, and you said this to somebody on social media this week, that's going to allow you to hide, right? It's, you can't fix. You're going to hide for development purposes the issues that you have back there. And I'm going to put issues in quotes because I don't feel it's an issue per se. I actually, in some cases, think we might have gotten an upgrade by getting rid of Earl Thomas to an extent. But adding him there, getting to the quarterback faster, you're able to hide that a little bit better.
Right. No, I agree with you. Like you said, though, it comes down to money for Jadeveon Clowney. It's been about money since day one, right? He's had multiple offers already by other teams, and he's turned them all down because he doesn't feel like he's getting his fair share market value-wise.
Yeah.
Will he take that lower deal on a one-year prove-it type deal, like he kind of did? You know, he didn't take the deal with Seattle because he was traded to Seattle.
Right.
But he went there on a, you know, on his last year of his contract, try to prove himself. Didn't, like you said, statistically wise, didn't put up the numbers that I guess we would expect for a pass rusher. But when you're talking Jadeveon Clowney, especially in this defense, the trickle down effect that he would have, and how much that frees up Calais Campbell, how much that frees up Derek Wolfe, how much that frees up Brandon Williams,
Matt Judon.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean the whole way across this defensive line, they're already, in my opinion, one of the most formidable defensive fronts in all of football right now, Jadeveon Clowney. If you bring a guy like that in, man, it's only going to help the entire unit.
Yeah, I mean, if you did that, there is no doubt. If the Ravens were to do that, there would be – you have no argument to say any other team has a better defensive front than the Ravens.
Right.
And to expose – you're just going to watch those guys expose every weakness on the front line of every team.
Right. Yeah,
all it takes – when you have a top – I'll say a top 10 player across the board at every position. In my opinion, we would, technically.
Right.
You have a top 10 at every position, one hole is going to stand out. One guy that's got bad footwork, it's going to stand out. Because this, it's not just how good they are. It's the knowledge of this group.
Yeah.
It's that's the other thing about these guys, especially Calais Campbell, who, from what I've seen from the videos, that – you know, Ravens are putting him out, and I know they're putting highlights out, but his coaching up of some of the young guys, and even talking to Brandon Williams, he's excited to be right next to Brandon Williams and get him going and get him more sacks.
My only concern with Jadeveon Clowney is, how good a shape is he in? Has he been taking care of his body? We talk about soft tissue issues with all these guys because they're not getting the contact that they're normally getting. They're not going through the drills they normally get. Well, what kind of drills has he been going through? Has he been keeping himself in that kind of shape? That's a lot of money. You know, if the Ravens could get him for $9 million, I don't know what the cap hit would be because of, you know, signing bonus, all that kind of stuff. They'd have to figure that number out. I think it makes sense, but I don't know. From a production standpoint, if we're talking Madden, it's just plug and play and don't have to worry about injury, of course. I want that all day long. Yeah. But realistically, like I said, it's a risk because he has been a locker room problem, right? He's a me guy. John Harbaugh doesn't like me guys traditionally. So it would be an interesting fit, and here we are a week before the season starts.
Yeah, and Steve brings it because he said he thinks Clowney would help in the run defense and setting the edge. That was a problem last season.
100%.
It was. We know that Nick Chubb got us. We know that Henry got us. So, yeah, if you can solidify that front line, we talked about what was the biggest thing. That's what they did in this offseason.
Yeah.
Clowney would definitely be an upgrade from what we have. The question becomes, do we need him for what we'd have to pay to get him?
Right.
That's yet to be seen for any team.
Right.
Because whatever the contracts were, he wasn't willing to bite. Maybe they weren't contenders, and that's why he didn't want to bite. We don't know all the details of every team and what he's been offered.
Right.
I'd imagine there's somebody that's come close to what he's wanting.
Yeah.
So if he didn't want to go there, do you want to come play for a championship team?
This is the championship team. You got a legit shot at winning a Super Bowl.
Are you willing to take less money to go get a ring?
Right.
That then makes you look better to go get the money next year.
But I don't know Jadeveon Clowney from Adam, but from what I've gathered and what I've read, he just doesn't seem like a ring chaser kind of guy. He's about pay me. He's about his money, right, at the end of the day. But some things that we do know, right? One thing, Jeff Zerbeck, great writer for The Athletic, reporter for the Ravens, wrote an article that was released today that he talked about the good, bad, and the ugly so far at Ravens training camp with things getting wrapped up, right? So I wanted to kind of digest this a little bit, some of the key points that he kind of pointed out, because I agree with pretty much everything that he said in this article. If you don't follow Jeff Zerbeck, you're missing out, because this guy is the best of the best when it comes to Ravens writers. So for the good, right, and I think this goes without even being said for the Ravens, I guess the best part of training camp in 2020 is the Ravens' ability to keep COVID away, right? Yeah. So far, like, they've only had one person who had to sit out for any length of period of time. That was Nigel Warrior, the undrafted free agent safety.
We'll get into him in a few minutes.
Yeah, we'll talk a little bit about him. So outside of that, knock on wood, COVID hasn't been an issue for the Ravens.
Yeah. I mean, it's been nice to see. I mean, we've seen it. This is the one year that I really wish Hard Knocks would have done the Ravens.
Right. Just so you can see what they're going through. And
right.
What doing.
To see what they're going through, see what they're doing, and to be seeing the, you know, I know they traditionally haven't done it, but how is the MVP handling the pressure?
Right.
Right. That inside look, I think, would be amazing to see.
Yeah.
I know why the Ravens didn't want him, because you ain't giving away tape more than you already have to.
Right. Right.
But That's true. The same token, I think it's great to see. It shows you that they have the right protocols in place. As soon as they found out Nigel Warrior had the chance, they were like, gone.
Yep. Set protocol, out for 2 weeks.
You were out for 2 weeks. You're not allowed here. You got to have the two negative tests. And the thing that I think I read for them with him, anybody that tests positive for them or they have to go under quarantine, you can't have two rapid tests. You have to have two of the actual, like, get up in your nose and tickle your brain tests.
Right.
In order to get back into the facility and be even around the facility. So I think it's great. I think they've done a great job at trying to set a good standard, and to see that you've only had one guy go on there, it's awesome.
And Joe, I know it's early, right? You know, we're just getting wrapped up with training camp and everything so far. What's been your take on not just the Ravens, but how the NFL in general has been handling COVID and just – I'm going to say, without you know, jinxing anything or anything, keeping the numbers at bay and doing a really good job in a very physical sport.
58,000 tests across the league over the past month, month and a half, whatever those statistics are from. 6 positives.
Wow. That's crazy.
I mean,
yeah.
Call me a numbers guy.
Right.
But there it is.
Right.
I mean, we've seen it from the outside. Obviously, I've got all of the releases on what the protocols are, team by team, daily testing, this, that, and the other. They voted to extend the daily testing through the PA. the question that was asked, one of the things last time I was on the show about the penalties and everything if somebody refuses a test, and I said, look, it's not going to happen. There is a respect and an appreciation for what needs to happen to make sure that this show goes on, right, and it will be adhered to. And so far, it has. And that's really what it comes down to. They understand, and we'll get into this a little bit later, but this is a thing that is here or it is gone. You do A, B, and C, and you get to keep it.
Right.
You don't, and you don't.
Right.
And everybody seems to be playing along and doing what they need to do. They put the right protocols in place. They made teams, every single team submitted and had approved by the league and the PA exactly what the protocols were going to be before they let anybody back in the building.
Right.
And they've executed.
Yeah, I couldn't agree more.
Go ahead, James.
No, I'm good.
Oh, I thought you were.
James is out.
Well, one of the other good things that Jeff pointed out was obviously something we've been talking about on end for the last couple of weeks, and that's this young wide receiver core, right?
Oh, yeah.
Young wide receiver core. You got Hollywood Brown going into his second year. You got the two rookies in Duvernay and Prochet who are catching everything, but more than just catching everything, showing what their footwork could potentially be, you know, showing that they have the ability to – you know, create separation using some of their physicality. There's been a lot to like what we've seen so far in training camp with these young wide receivers.
Yeah, no, it's definitely something that when you look at what they've been able to do, and you showed me the video today of Prochet, right, high pointing the ball, going up with a one hand high point in the corner, coming down with it. And you heard, I don't know who it was, but you heard them after he came down with it go, woo!
Yeah.
Like they were excited, ready to go. And what these guys bring to the table has just been off the charts amazing. And the other good part about it, that's the flip side of that, right?
Right.
These guys are looking good, but Lamar's also looking good.
Yeah.
Right? Now, to everybody that got their panties in a bunch because it came out that Lamar threw an interception to Nigel Warrior, number one, that should tell you Nigel Warrior's looking good. He's healthy coming back from it, that he's able to do that. Yeah. First off,
I think he's got a good shot at making this roster.
I think he does, too. I think you'll see him. From what I've understood and from what I've read, you probably have seen a little bit more than I have. He also can be used, and we'll probably see Harbaugh use him as a special teams gunner,
right?
Because he does have the speed that he has the ability to, you know, to read the play and find things and find holes, right?
Yeah. So, I mean, if he's going to make this roster, he's going to have a special teams impact,
right?
That's just the way it is.
The other side to that is everybody that was freaking out that Lamar
threw a pick,
like
gonna happen.
Chill the hell out, because here's the deal. The other thing you didn't see and you didn't hear about was the fact that this motivated Lamar. After this happened, it motivated him, and he went on a tear after that interception.
Everything Lamar makes a mistake on motivates him to be better and not make that mistake.
Exactly. After that, he connected on 6 of 8 passes for 2 TDs, including a 40-yarder to Hollywood.
Yep.
And that was on him scrambling to his right, apparently, from what I was reading. He was scrambling to his right through almost off of his back foot, 40 yards to Hollywood for a TD.
Right.
And then also turned around and threw another one to Andrews across the middle in the red zone.
Yeah. Yeah.
I'm not worried about
Lamar Jackson. The only thing I'm worried about Lamar Jackson was that little gangster limp he had coming out the other day when he was dealing with the growing thing. That's the only issue I had with Lamar Jackson. But, another guy that stood out to everybody, and a guy that I'm very high on, I drafted him in the Birdland BS Fantasy League in round 11, J.K. Dobbins.
Yes.
He's going to be a guy that I think will pay dividends for my fantasy roster, and I think will pay dividends for the Ravens week one.
Yeah, I mean, he's come straight out, and this week, when John Harbaugh says somebody's going to have a significant role.
Yeah, that means something.
It means they're going to be playing a lot.
Right.
Like, we were talking before the show. To your point, he is not going to come out and be first snap starter.
Right.
But he will play in that first game.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
And he will get carries.
That doesn't mean that Mark Ingram is going to be forgot about, or that Mark Ingram won't have a role
in this offense, or Gus Edwards.
Right. I think the guy that might be the odd man out is one of my favorites from last year that didn't get a whole lot of a play, Justice Hill. He's just going to be buried on the depth chart, unfortunately. But
yeah.
J.K. Dobbins, what he can bring, not only as a runner, but as a pass catcher out of the backfield, I think he just adds a whole nother dynamic to this team. And again, it'll help keep Ingram fresh longer into the season, which will only benefit this team as we get into week 14, 15, 16, and we start making that playoff push at the end.
Yeah, is when you have the depth like this, to your point, if Ingram goes down, somebody goes down, Justice Hill's just there. This is going to increase Justice Hill's role when it comes to special teams.
Yeah,
for sure.
We might see him involved more in the return game, which I know you've been clamoring for a while.
I think that's a perfect fit for him.
Yeah.
So I think it makes sense. I think the one big thing other than that.
Don't say it. Knock on wood. Grab your like lucky rabbit's foot. Don't, do something.
Don't be doing that again. That looks bad. Don't do that. But no, the one thing that has been nice, and I will knock on wood, no major injury concerns to any of our star players,
yeah,
or you know, anything that's going to play a major role,
yeah,
in hurting this team's moving forward and having a good season.
Ravens last couple years have had luck on their side when it goes to that, as far as getting through training camp, getting through, you know, preseason, all that stuff fairly healthy, especially like you said with their star players. So hopefully we got one more week to go, right?
Yeah.
Hopefully they get through that week without any injuries. You know, we've had some little things happen, some guys that were bubble guys that are going to be IR'd and aren't going to be a part of the roster this year, but nobody of any significant impact. The only one that is a significant impact was his bad, or was part of his bad, and we'll talk a little bit about him, Earl Thomas. Obviously, that's not even bad. That's ugly, right? That whole scenario, that wasn't even bad. That was just ugly.
Let's just get that out of the way. That was Travis Rebeck's ugly.
Yeah.
Because that whole situation, we talked about it, and I know we got crap from some people last week talking to like, oh, you know, you guys were all on. Yes, we were all on Earl Thomas, and it was exciting to see. But the problem is he came on and nothing, absolutely nothing changed. He was still a me guy. When you're saying I want to wash my car over and I need to be need to be late to a team meeting because I want to wash my car,
yeah,
that's not okay. Like Joe, if one of your guys said that to you, oh, I'm going to be late to that tryout because I got to wash my car, what would your response be as his agent?
Car.
Say that again.
How are you paying for that car?
Yeah, exactly. Right. Who gave you said car?
Right.
Yeah, so obviously, yeah, Earl Thomas, really the only ugly. But there are some bad, right? There are some things that I think some of us as Ravens fans are concerned about, one of which was the offensive line. I think we have some depth on the interior, but as far as like that backup tackle spot, you know, we lost James Hurst. Right, Andre Smith decided to opt out for the year, so we don't really have a ton of depth at tackle. So you're one injury away from a Ronnie Stanley, yeah, or you know, an Orlando Brown from really depleting a key part of what keeps Lamar Jackson up.
Well, and they talked about today. I was watching a little bit of the Ravens training camp when it came on this morning, and one of the things they were actually focusing on talking about was the offensive line. And to them, the biggest question right now is there's still not a clear starter at center.
Yeah.
Is it going to be a McCarty? Is it going to be Skura? Is it going to be McCarty to start till you feel Skura's got his like fully
I think
under
that's,
him?
I think that's what it is with Skura. It's not a performance thing with Skura, because I think if Skura was 100% healthy,
oh, he'd be in there.
He'd
period.
Be the
yeah.
question, no question starter, but I just don't know how confident they are that he's 100% yet.
No, I don't think you can be. I don't think you rush that injury back, especially, no, you know, a guy his size. And we talked
about McCarty filled in good.
Yeah, no, McCarty did great, and they said McCarty could definitely handle it. And I think the big concern is you gotta find some depth and you gotta have some depth. There's a few guys that they were kind of mentioning back and forth. I think one of them was Williams that they were talking. I think his name was Williams. I'm trying to remember who was on the line there when they were talking about it. Somebody that was just he was doing a spot fill during that drill, and they were like, you know, he could be a good fill in if McCarty's at center, which they did have McCarty at center snapping the ball to Skura, which was right. funny, but. It is concerning when if you have one of these guys go down, and if you're going to have a soft tissue injury, this is one of the guys that can get it.
Yeah.
On a block, you come down wrong. He's blocking a guy. The guy right. comes down wrong on his knee. Maybe he's not, you know, he hasn't, especially Skura.
Yeah.
He's not fully 100%. You're taking a real risk here. You got to find some depth.
So tying it into what Joba does, right, and players that you represent and all that stuff, offensive line, I think, is going to be at a premium for some of these undrafted guys, some of these free agents that are out there. I don't think there's going to be, because with the practice squads obviously expanding, right, I think there's going to be more opportunities, and I think teams are going to hang on to offensive line depth more. Am I wrong in thinking that way?
No, you're completely right, and we're going to see the league. It's not going to take effect this year, but in next year, within the new CBA that was just ratified back in March, mm-hmm. when the rosters expand above the 53, there are designated extra spots in there specifically for offensive linemen.
Right.
And that shows how important that is from a depth perspective. I think that we're going to see more of them in the practice squads, and you know there's going to be depth there. And those guys are always guys that are in a premium year in and year out because they are – I mean, when that wall goes down, everything that's important that you're spending – tens of millions of dollars on against your cap is sitting there behind it.
Exactly. Yeah. Exactly. I couldn't agree more. And then, you know, as much as credit as we give Eric DaCosta and the job that he's done since he's taken over as a GM for, you know, Ozzie Newsome and everything, yeah. The other bad that I thought was kind of interesting when you put it in perspective that Jeff Zerebak pointed out was how this 2019 draft class is shaking up now a year later. Right, you start looking at some of these guys. You got Daylon Mack, who it was released, you know, right at the beginning of camp. You got Amon Marshall, who went down with the injury. Right, he was a fifth round pick. You got Ben Powers, who we talked about the offensive line depth. He's one of those bubble guys interior. Right, he might not make this roster right now.
He hasn't been doing anything to impress very many people. I'll tell you that. I haven't seen. We didn't see it last year.
Right.
We said that was one of the things that we were surprised that we didn't see him make an impression, and he apparently hasn't this year either.
Right. Exactly. And then you got Justice Hill, who we just talked about a couple minutes ago. I think it's not a skill set thing with him. I don't think it's not that he doesn't have the ability to play at the NFL level. He's just buried on the depth chart. He's now the fourth running back on this squad. He's obviously been dealing with a little bit of injuries here and there too, but he's buried. He's not going to get a ton of opportunities this year unless there's an injury of some sort. So you got that issue. Jalen Ferguson, who we're looking to step up to that next round or that next level this year, he's been dealing with back injuries. You know, it's just one thing after the other. And then the quarterback battle. You got Trace McSorley, who they spent a 6th round pick on, you know, as a quarterback
right,
last year.
And then Huntley's coming in and showing him up.
Yeah, they bring this undrafted guy in, and everything that you're reading about and everything that you're hearing is that Huntley's outperforming McSorley. So that's going to put the Ravens in an interesting spot. Do they keep McSorley? Do they keep 3 quarterbacks? Do they stash McSorley on the practice squad? Does he get cut? What happens there? But, again, that's 6 guys from last year's draft class that there's a lot of question marks around.
Yeah, it's definitely cause for concern because – that was DaCosta's first draft, right? First draft on his own.
On his own.
And, you know, yeah, it's not bad. When you look at those guys for what they were last year, just different situations. The Justice Hill situation was one that I look at, and to your point, he buried on the depth chart. We got lucky, you know, we got the contract out of Mark Ingram. That was great. Gus Edwards has just continued. You didn't know whether you were going to see his evolution or not.
Right.
You saw it, right? So you have those two guys, and then he kind of got lost in the fray. And to our point, I don't think he was used enough last year on the kick return, because if he was, that would have given him more ability to show what he can do with the shiftiness, how he can read the field, how he can read plays, and then be able to do it a little bit more. But then going out and getting Dobbins this year, there's no way that, in my opinion, especially with what we've seen out of Dobbins, even pre-Dobbins coming into camp, I don't know that you could have ever have said that Dobbins was under Hill at any point in time.
No. I don't even think from the day he was drafted he was ever under.
No.
At all. Joe, did you have anything?
Well, I mean, it's a good position to be in, especially with guys in different, you know, different skill sets there as far as the running backs are concerned. Having a guy like Hill go and return more kicks and be active there isn't really a bad thing. And I think that, you know, we saw this last year. There was a press conference where Harbaugh let it slip about the somebody said, I don't know whether it was the over-under on Lamar's runs or if they were talking about how many run plays he had the year before, and Harbaugh just spits it out, and he's like, I go with the over. Like, sometimes he's not Bill Belichick.
Right.
Yeah. He's not on to Cleveland, okay? Sometimes right. he lets those little
He'll
nuggets
give you those
slip
nuggets, that's right.
That yeah. will say, hey, look, this guy's a guy. And I'll tell you right now, as long as Dobbins can get that mesh point down like Ingram had, like science,
right,
then you're going to see a lot of him, and you're going to have a fresh Ingram late in the season. They're going to use Ingram when they need to. If Dobbins can master that mesh point the way for those plays, and that they can play that same style like they did seamlessly, then it's going to be fun to watch. Let's put it that way.
Yeah, and I think Joe brought up a good point, kind of going back to Trace for a quick second. When it comes to Trace, right?
Yeah.
When you look at him, he was supposed to be the Swiss Army knife, right? Like a what's his face for the Saints?
Oh, Hill.
Hill, yeah, Taysom Hill. There we go. Hill. So he was supposed to be, you know, our version of Taysom Hill. That's what everybody was saying. We didn't see him get used like that last year.
Not at all.
And this year, I don't see them carrying four quarterbacks. I just don't.
Oh, they're
see
definitely
it.
Not going to carry four. It's just a matter of if they carry three and they choose to carry Trace on the active roster at three, do they stash a fourth on the practice?
Are you
going
to be able to hide Huntley with how well he's been performing,
though?
That's going to be the problem.
That's a big
I don't
question.
Know that you're going to be able to hide him.
Right.
Because everything is saying that this kid fits into your system better and is outperforming what Trace McSorley is. Let's not forget, what is everybody trying to mimic right now? Everybody is trying to mimic the Chiefs and the Ravens because those are the two offensive schemes that seem to be the most successful. And what does that involve? It involves mobile quarterbacks that can get away. Trace can do it, but not at the level Huntley can.
Yeah.
And that's what makes Huntley more valuable.
Huntley's still got a lot to prove, man. All we've watched is a little bit of training camp footage, some 11-11. He's got to prove it when the lights come on in the stadium, that kind of thing. And we're not going to see that, unfortunately, because we're not going to see any kind of preseason.
Agree or disagree? Do you think they have a better shot at stashing McSorley over stashing Huntley?
I think it's kind of equal. I don't think there's one that is going to intrigue a team that much more than the other. I'd prefer to keep Huntley because I think Huntley fits this offensive scheme a little bit better. I did like what I saw out of McSorley, not at training camp, but once the lights came on and he was on the field in the preseason last year, I liked what I saw. But so far, I mean, just everything that I've seen and everything I've read about Huntley seems like he'd be a good fit in this offense.
It's definitely been impressive, and I'll be curious. The other thing that I'll be curious about, and we were talking about this before, tight end three, right?
Yeah.
We know that we like to go with a three tight end set. It really works with this offense. The question now is, after what's happened this past week, who the hell is going to be your tight end three?
Well, so a lot of the rumors, and we had talked about this for a while, was the potential use of Pat Ricard, not just as a fullback, but because of his versatility and his ability to catch the ball out of the backfield, using him in certain formations as a tight end three. And I think that makes a lot of sense. The problem is, and I think our buddy Matt Wise over at Russell Street Report brought this up, and I thought it was a valid point. If you carry Pat Ricard as your true tight end number three, right, and Pat Ricard goes down, a section of your playbook goes down at that point.
Well, a section of your playbook on every side.
Right.
Fullback, tight end, on the defensive line.
But I'm just talking about the tight end three position, right? So if you've got a guy, you've got a couple guys out there right now. You got Charles Scarf, who they said that they were going to cut the other day, but then
they literally told him
they were going to cut him, and then Eli Wolf got banged up, and they're like, wait a minute, psych, we're not going to cut you yet. We'll hang on a little bit. So you got Eli Wolf and Jarrell Adams kind of banging it out there for that last tight end three spot if it's not going to be Ricard. Wolf just can't stay on the field. He's been having some injuries things pop up here and there. So you'd like to see that go away. You know, you don't want to bring in a guy that's going to have injury issues all year. I like Pat Ricard as a tight end three. I just, like he said, like Matt Wise said, I think it's a great point. If you rely on him as your primary TE3 and he goes down with an injury, that removes a good section of your playbook. I think Pat Ricard can still be used as a tight end three in situations if you have that added depth piece and you use a roster spot for another true tight end three.
Yeah, I think with everything that he brings you, you know, you're talking about that. I'm looking at the fact that you lose him. You lose his ability on defense. You lose his ability as a fullback. I don't like it. I don't like the idea of saying that he's your tight end three.
Yeah.
I like saying that you can use him in a tight end three set if you needed to.
Right.
But you need to come out. If you're going to run that type of playbook, excuse me, you've got to have it. And I think it's seeming and sounding more and more like it. Jarrell Adams might be that guy.
Yeah. Everything that they're saying, that might be the guy that ends up holding this fort down. Like I said, if Eli Wolf, they like what he can and bring as a pass-catching tight end, but if you can't stay on the field, you do us no good.
Yeah, I don't know. I don't know where I'm going to go this. If you ask me if I'm a betting man who's on, I don't know who I can tell you.
Speaking of bets, let's talk some bets, right? We talked about this in the show. And if we're talking bets, man, we got to be talking about our guys over at MyBookie because it's winning season right now over at MyBookie, and winning season means doubling your first deposit. That's right. MyBookie's hooking up all of our BSers out there with double your first deposit up to $1,000, Scott.
Damn. MyBookie has it all, guys. They've got Survivor. They've got Super Contest. They've got Squares, along with full season, individual games, and prop bets. It's time to get excited for the NFL season with MyBookie, guys.
Invest in yourself. Invest in your sports knowledge. Use our promo code BirdlandBS, and they will double your first deposit up to $1,000. It just adds a whole nother level of excitement to the sports you love and the games you bet. It's simple. Make your picks, win big, and collect your money.
I'm all about collecting that money. And again, guys, use that promo code BirdlandBS to double your first deposit and start your winning season today only at MyBookie. And there it is right there. There it is. Birdland BS. Go check it out.
I was on there today. I made my first deposit today, and I wanted to take a look at what some of these bets were out there for the Ravens.
So I made mine. I got mine doubled. Did you get yours doubled?
Yeah, I did. I got mine doubled.
Better use the promo code.
Of course. So let's talk a little bit about these bets. I want to get Joba's opinion on some of these, too, just to see. I don't know if you're a betting kind of guy, but we're going to talk a little bit about this, right? So some of the Ravens bets that they had in here, they went specifically with Lamar, right? These are all just over-under bets, you know? Lamar, regular season passing yards, 2020.
Okay.
Over, under, 31.99.5.
Regular season passing yards.
Passing yards. Not total yards, just passing yards.
I'll take the over.
I'll take the over on that as well. I think he was right there last year. I think he takes that next step. I think a fresher Hollywood, the added, you know, rookie wide receivers.
He was just over 3,000 last year, right? Somewhere around
there? Yeah, he was right around that number. I don't know the exact number. He was right around that number last year. I think he will make that next step. I think he'll be closer to, like, the 3,500 mark this year, passing stats. What do you think, Joe?
He's definitely going to have the opportunity to do it. He's going to have, as you said, there's more weapons there, healthier weapons there, a more developed Hollywood Brown. And I think that we're going to see a league that's going to stack up and prepare for him to run more, which is going to open him up to pass more.
I agree. All right, so sticking with it then, last year he led the league in passing touchdowns, right? A guy who they said couldn't throw the ball, led the league in passing touchdowns. What, he had 36 last year? Something around that? I think it was 36. Yeah. Over, under, 26.5 this year.
I'm taking the over again.
To me, that's a layup.
That's a no-brainer.
That's a layup. I'm not not a betting guy. This just seems to be too easy. If he stays healthy, 26.5 touchdowns this year? Am I crazy on that?
I don't think so.
If I were allowed to bet on NFL sports, which obviously as an agent I'm not,
right?
I'd back up the truck on the over on this one. This is, I mean, is he? Can you expect him to have a little backslide?
Right.
From the 36, 100%. But you're talking about 26. That's
a third?
That's a third off. I mean, are they going to clinch the division in week 10?
Right.
Yeah. Go ahead, James.
James?
Fred, Scott, I'm loving all this because I picked him third overall. So thank you for all the over. All the over you guys are giving me. I love it.
That is true.
Anyway.
All right, so then moving on to his favorite target, his probably best friend on the team, right, Hollywood Brown. Over, under, 849.5 receiving yards this year. I'm going to go easy on this. I told you I think this guy can be 1,100 to 1,300 yards this year. Maybe I'm crazy. Maybe I'm drinking the purple Kool-Aid. But I really think 849 yards, that's another layup here.
The only thing I can think, I agree with you, and I'm taking you over here. The only thing I can think on some of these is that they're looking that there's so many weapons on the team that it starts taking away from guys because you can really start to spread the ball anywhere, and you don't know how that's truly going to affect. But one thing we can rely on are two guys on that offense. Hollywood Brown, who was at 80% last year and almost beat that number right now.
Right.
We talked about it. He can reach 100% and be a 1,300-yard guy. I think it's an over. I think it's slam dunk. And the other guy is Andrews, who we're going to get into here in a second. But the other thing they said was the over-under on his reception TDs.
Yeah.
They have him at the over-under on 7.5 for the year. What do you think?
So this is the one that I don't – the 7.5 touchdowns is going to have to come from breakaway plays. For me, yeah. Hollywood Brown isn't a red zone threat, right? That's where you're going to see the likes of Miles Boykin. I think that's where you're going to see the likes of Mark Andrews. I think you're going to see even Devin Duvernay might have a role in that as far as red zone targets go. This is the one – that I'm almost like a push on. So if I'm going to go under on any statistic that I saw today, this might be the one I go under.
I think I'm right there with you. For me, this I look at this and say this is more of that push. I think you could wind up seeing him have 7.
Right.
Because there are other guys that you're going to, I feel like, rely on in the red zone a lot more. Andrews, you're going to rely on a lot more. You're going to rely on Boykin if he's high-pointing the ball. We've seen Snead has had a great camp.
Yeah.
And a lot of it has been within the red zone from everything I've been reading. So
agreed.
I think there's a lot to be said there. And to your point, if it's going to happen, it's going to be breakaways. Joveth, what do you think?
I mean, you've pretty much identified his skill set and more so the skill set of the other players on the team. We saw last year a lot more red zone from anybody else. I mean, he's 5'7", 5'8".
Yeah.
He's not your red zone target.
Right.
He is exactly what he was. I mean, we saw it from the jump.
Right.
In Miami last year,
yep.
Just, hey, look, I got all these yards and 6.
Right.
And that's when you're going to see it next year.
I agree. Well, the one big red zone target that none of us will argue this is going to be his number one target in the red zone, Mark Andrews. So the over-under on these, receiving yards and receiving touchdowns, receiving yards, over-under 899.5, so essentially 900 yards. Receiving touchdowns, over under 9.5.
I love Andrews, and he loves to get him across the middle. But Andrews is also a chunk yardage guy.
Yeah.
He's, you know, I say chunk, but it's a smaller chunk, so let me put it that way. He's your guy that you're, when you need three, four yards, you're going to him a lot.
Yeah.
Because of that, this is the only other spot when I looked at all these that I actually would go under.
Under.
Yeah.
So for me, I'm going over, and here's why.
Are you? Okay.
I think not having Hayden Hurst out there and having the question marks at tight end number 3 is only going to increase the production for Mark Andrews. You're going to see him on the field even more than he was last year. I think the chemistry that they were able to build between him and Lamar in their first full season together is unmatched. I know him and Hollywood are best friends, but there's no denying. Mark Andrews, the one thing that I've liked since day one about Mark Andrews is – he's that backyard guy. Like, we talk about Lamar being a backyard guy. Mark Andrews will run his route, right? And if he's covered or he sees Lamar fighting or trying to scramble, he comes back to the ball. He comes back to Lamar. He finds open space. He ad-libs to find open space and make a catch. That's why I think Mark Andrews is going to go over 1,000 yards receiving this year. Joveth, what do you got on Mark?
I think when you were talking about the chunk yards, I see him as more of the chain mover. And he's the guy that whether it be 3 you need, 4 you need, 5 you need, you know, we're done with where we were in the past with this team of it's 6 yards to a first down and we're going to throw it 5.
Right, right.
That's over. That's been over since Lamar was here. We're getting there. We've got the guys. We've got the tools to get those first downs. We saw a lot of it with Andrews, and I think we're going to see more of it. So – again, if I've got to pick one out of these to stay under on, this is probably one of my ones.
Okay.
I certainly think that 1,000 is a lot, but, I mean, with Lamar, anything's possible.
Right.
Yeah.
I will say, again, the only other one that I was kind of on the cusp of maybe a push would have been the touchdowns on this at 9.5 touchdowns. So if I'm going to go under on anything on Mark Andrews, I think I'm going to go under on the touchdowns.
See, I'm the complete opposite because he's such a red zone target.
I know.
I get
that.
I think he's the over there.
I just basically put my foot in my mouth of what I just said a minute ago. I get that.
I think it's there. The other thing that I think comes into play on the yardage side, and just kind of going back to that for a quick second, is the fact that you know he's a favorite. It is. It was well known last year, but now it's even more well known that he's a favorite target.
Right.
So he's going to be when Lamar isn't having the greatest game.
Right.
going to be real easy to figure out who he's going to throw the ball to.
Yeah.
And it's going to be easier to cover. So some of that yardage
just
starts coming off.
Security blanket.
Exactly. Some of that yardage starts coming off because now you start forcing him to make that deep throw to Hollywood, forcing him to find Miles Boykin, forcing him to find one of the rookies.
Right.
And develop that with them. Don't beat me with the guy that I know you can beat me with. Beat me with the guy that I don't know what you're going to be able to do with when the lights come on.
Right.
So
it's a good point.
My thought.
It's a good point. So another sport that fans love to bet on, college football. Right. And obviously, we're not going to be betting on any Terps college football games anytime soon.
Sorry, Ryan.
Jobeth was able to go down to Alabama this past week, just a couple days ago, right? Was it Saturday?
Yeah, the game was Saturday. I flew down to Atlanta Friday night, drove into Montgomery about 2 hours away. And, I mean, it was an interesting time. We're recruiting a guy down there. Part of what I wanted to take a look at and report back to you guys and everybody that's watching right now was, what's it all look like? Because
right.
This was a limited capacity game.
I'm itching to know, man.
Look, I'll tell you right now, from what I observed compared to what I expected, if itching were a side effect or whatnot of COVID, you would not be itching right now. And I expected a totally different, like, screw this, it doesn't exist, we're just going to push on with this kind of mentality in the South, in Alabama, and it was not that. It was... I mean, I had people, when they found out that I was going down there, reached out to me being like, bro, are you really doing this? Because that's not a great idea.
Right.
I brought back, and there's some still images and some
Brian,
video.
Pull up the image that he showed us. This is your vantage point from sitting at the stadium as to what it looked like across the field.
Right. So this is – I mean, there's a grandstand on either side of the stadium. You know, we're in a field that doesn't – nothing on the end zones. And this picture was taken probably about 5-10 minutes before kickoff, before the start of the game.
Wow. Man.
And that's the opposite side. So
to put this in perspective, right, I think they said there was supposed to be like 3,000 to 5,000 people there in this stadium that night at Saturday. And the stadium capacity, I think you said, holds what, 25,000 fans?
Full capacity is 25,000. So you're looking at probably about 15% to 20%. In the stands.
Which that's exactly what it would have looked like at Ravens Stadium if they would have opened the stadium with 14,000 fans like they originally talked about.
Right.
It looks like there's 10 people there.
Right.
Yeah. There's nobody there, and you could tell that they're all spaced out, right? You're just looking across the way, but
pull up the video. Take this one down. Pull up the video and show. He kind of gives you a little bit of perspective of what it looked like around him. There's tape on the seats. You can clearly see that everybody's sitting 6 feet apart, if not more. There's really not any bigger groups than maybe three or four people sitting
together.
And
even the groupings, when the video, we got on loop here so you guys can kind of see it something different each time. But when the video first starts here, just a second, you can see there's a decent amount of people down there. But you can tell from your vantage point there, they were definitely all spread out. They had their groups of people that were, you know, family or friends that were sitting right next to each other and comfortable. But for the most part, everybody was further away.
Yeah, this one here, as you can see, because the team is there on the sideline as I'm panning through, if you look all the way down to the bottom, the game was on at this point in time.
Right. Yeah.
The way that they had this set up, it appeared to be, number one, you had to buy these tickets through the team specifically. So,
oh, really?
We've got a player down there that we are recruiting, and we worked through his team to get my agent partner and I. So we got a group of tickets for us, mm-hmm. and it looks like what they basically did was what seemed to be like a four-row rule.
Right.
And as you can see, in front of me to the beginning of the section, four empty rows. In my row, nobody to my left, and they put us all the way to the right. The four rows down, the people that were in those seats were assigned seats that were all the way to the left. It was almost like they set it up as a checkerboard.
Oh,
wow. And when you saw probably from across the stand, like chunks of people, it would have been because, like, in our group, we bought three tickets. And in the group that was down and to the left of us, who was actually the family of one of the players on the Central Arkansas team, I think there were probably five or six people there. So there was a bigger chunk there. But again, they still spread them from us. As it panned around to the back, it was four rows back, and then again all the way to our left,
right,
and
yeah.
so on and so forth. So what,
were the ushers and the staffing there doing anything to make sure that everybody was being social distanced?
So they're
staying that way.
There didn't really seem to be that much of an issue of people crowding together, but they definitely had event staff that was rolling through, making sure that people were wearing masks.
Okay.
I mean, I certainly definitely look back at this and see that I shot a picture with a handful of people that weren't wearing masks at the time, but you could see that they all had them.
Right.
And the event staff was rolling through. I mean, this was an ESPN televised game, so they didn't want any of that showing up. It needed to look good. And there were, from the announcer, regular announcements, keep the masks on. Early on at the very start of the game, it was that same mentality that I described when it came to everybody in the NFL adhering to the rules of, hey, look, they're letting us do this. Don't screw it up.
Right.
And here are the ways to not screw it up. Keep your mask on. Don't do stupid. And, you know.
You can say it. You mean it.
Do it right. Oh, yeah, yeah. We're not. There's no FCC.
There's
here.
No okay, sense so, on this. So one of our listeners, Steve, brings up a good point. He says, watching this and seeing this video clip, why isn't this something that the Ravens could do? And my simple answer on this is it's Hogan, right? Hogan is standing in the way of approving this, correct?
I mean, not anymore.
I don't want to get ultra political.
No,
about
I know,
it,
I know. I get it.
But the first home game is on the 13th, which is a Sunday, as most NFL games are.
Right.
Let there be a press conference. I'm not gonna, you know, predict this here, but maybe there's a press conference on Thursday or Friday. the 10th or 11th, saying, you know what, it's all good. We saw them do it with the schools. Hey,
that's
it's
true.
All got to be, you know, tight. Just kidding. You guys can go back.
Mad rush for people to buy tickets.
Yeah. we want y'all back by November. You know, the problem is, and I don't mean to point the blame on him, but this has been a moving target. This has been a fluid situation since March.
Right.
It has been all over the place. You know, the conversations that I have to have with players that are looking for opportunities is, I mean, it's almost like a new conversation every day. Hey, what's going on? The last time I was on the show, when I showed up here in the studio,
right,
NFL teams couldn't have free agents in to work them out. By the time I left the studio last time, they could.
They left.
So
yeah.
It's not just coming from the governor. Specifically here it is.
Right.
What I don't think would happen is this, and this comes more from the organization and what I know of the Ravens and the operation that they run, is that if the script and what they're permitted to do was all of a sudden going to change at the last minute, they're not going to half-ass it, okay?
Right.
You're not going to the Browns game,
right?
Yeah, at the bank. Even if they're allowed to, they're not gonna be like, okay, cool, let's sell some tickets.
And it's funny you say that because Brian pulled it up. Steve from Facebook says, "I feel like the Ravens fans won't screw it up." And it's not just Ravens fans, but it's to your point,
the organization.
If there's any organization that can get it right, it's going to be the Ravens, right? That's kind of how I feel about it. All right, so let's talk a little bit about the game itself, right? You go down there. This is what they call week zero in college football, right? Yeah. Which is usually a couple of key marquee games from a couple of different conferences, whatnot. This was one game. It was Austin Peay versus Central Arkansas, like you said, in a neutral location down in Montgomery, Alabama. From a game perspective, right, we talked about betting, right? How did this game go? Did it go as to what everybody expected it to go, or were there some hiccups along the way? Because what I saw, first play of the game, was a big play.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, I think that you guys have probably mentioned Jim Nagy, who runs the Senior Bowl.
Yes.
In past episodes and everything like that. First play from scrimmage, 25-yard line, option play, pitch to the running back, boom, to the house.
Right.
And immediately there's a tweet from Nagy saying the over looks good here. The over was 47.5, I think. I looked at it ahead of time. And
we're 20 seconds in and we already got a touchdown.
We're 20 seconds in. We got 7 on the board. Like,
right.
Cash that ticket now. And then it didn't happen. Like, it severely slowed down from there. You know, things really tightened up. I can tell you that the quarterback for Central Arkansas found his groove through the game, but certainly was not the most accurate early on.
Right.
They had a lot of fits. There was an issue on Austin Peay with their long snapper, so
right.
They ended up having to do this direct snap to the quarterback on fourth down and whatever, where he's drop kicking the ball because these are not opportunities to say, hey, we're gonna run a fake punt here.
Right.
It was just such an odd situation because the starting long snapper was under quarantine still, so he did not make the trip with the team. I don't think he had COVID, but it was a precautionary quarantine. So they had a guy where it was basically like, hey, third string linebacker, whoever it was. I'm not sure who it was. You ever long snap? Come on, let's go.
Like, James, we need you to long snap.
The conversation probably went somewhat like that.
Right.
And, hey, look, this year doesn't count anyway, so take the red shirt off and let's go.
Right.
Again, I don't know the story behind it, so don't quote me on any of that.
Right.
But it didn't look pretty on the field in the warm-ups, and I was like, ooh, this is going to be a problem. And sure enough, it was. And by the second half, they were not there were no – no long snaps from Austin Peay.
Well, there's a lot of stuff in this game from what I was reading that was like just craziness between the start off, you know, with running down the line there, the fact that no long snapper, and then something I guess right after the initial run into for the touchdown, I guess the one judge referee didn't have he didn't realize that his mic was on. And so hot mic'd into the national broadcast, he goes, goddamn mask.
So that being in the stands, hey-o. I was not privy to. I know that there are some people who will sit there and listen to audio of the TV broadcast while they're watching a game. That's something I've never bought into. But, let's put it this way. From a different perspective and where I was sitting, there were times throughout this game where some calls went such a way that there were other people in the stands yelling, hey, that mask shouldn't be covering your eyes.
Right.
Again, I don't want to disparage them, but there were certainly comments made about that. And you know, the refs were all wearing masks. The coaches were wearing masks. And I think that they're going to institute similar rules in the NFL. The only people on the field in the NFL season that are not wearing masks are going to be the players. And I know they've got those special face shields and everything like that. But so anyway, within that betting theme, as I mentioned, the over-under was 47.5. It looked good early, and then it really stalled. It became a you know, one of those field position games. And it got to the point where Central Arkansas, who was favored, I think, at the time of that the game started, at most books was probably like 4.5. Mm-hmm. They were out to a pretty decent lead for a while, and then it was very, very late in the game. The ball got moving for Austin Peay. They went ahead, and it looked like it was done. And they made this, you know, with a quarterback who had not been accurate through most of the game, in that two-minute drill, he found that groove and he made it happen. And there was a really nice, you know, one of those corner end zone fades that came down, and, you know, they came away and literally with about 38 seconds in the game scored to end up not only winning, but cover. And they were on one of those drives where it's, hey, get down there and, you know, kick the field goal and you win. And I don't know whether somebody sent a text to the coach that reminded him that good coaches win and great coaches cover, but, you know, he went down there and made it happen. So,
wow. Yeah. I know for me, like I said, I didn't get to watch the game. I watched a few of the highlights, the guys, I guess a couple of guys that stood out to me as far as the game goes. And I know you're not going to give out too much information about players or anything, but I did see the running back for Austin Peay, I thought looked good in that game. Obviously, not just the run that he had to open the game, but I thought he had good athleticism, good speed, good vision.
CJ Evans, by the way.
And speaking of tight end three for the Ravens, right? Well, Southern Arkansas had a guy that looked pretty good at the tight end position who just mauled over a linebacker for Central Peay. Looked like he was a mauler, looked like a beast to me. Yeah. And again, it was small sample size, but I liked what I saw.
Yeah, look, if anybody wants information on this guy, because the film is fun to watch from this game specifically, Jake Small is his name.
Yeah.
And as we were panning through, actually those people that were up and to the left of us were his family. So he ended up, if you search for him somewhere, you'll see him on Barstool. And I learned that he was on Barstool because the brother who was sitting in that front row of my section got super excited. Jake's on Barstool. You know, for like 10 minutes, but hey, whatever.
He right. Was, he got was, his moment to shine.
He was the brother was probably about 10 beers in, so, you know, sometimes the length of time that you're excited about something gets a little bit extended. But hey, I get, you know, that's a big deal. There was another play earlier in the game, same guy rolling out, catches one of those, you know, shorter tight end passes, gets pushed out of bounds into this big piece of equipment that he just barrels through. I mean, this guy is a beast.
Yeah, looked like it to me too.
You know, and who knows? He may get some attention because Central Arkansas is a team that's going to have, at least as it's on paper right now, going to have a full season.
Right.
Austin Peay, on the other hand, has two more games on the schedule. So any players that were on that team that are eligible to come back are not going to get the same kind of reps that anybody else would. But overall, it looks like they're running a tight operation, and they're gonna see this thing through. And unless there's something crazy that happens, I don't see why it doesn't get to the finish line.
Yeah. Well, that sounds like a good experience. I mean, it sounds like they were able to keep everything at bay. Sounds like the operational from an operational standpoint, they were able to make everything work the way it would be right. expected to work. And again, to Steven's point, I feel like if they can do this at the collegiate level, an organization like the Ravens, maybe there are some out there that I wouldn't trust.
Yeah.
But the Ravens organization would definitely be one that I would trust to have 14,000 fans in the stands.
Yeah, I think they could definitely figure it out and make sure that it's something that is working. And, you know, you're, to his point, checkerboarding it, you could absolutely do that.
Yeah.
The one thing that I don't think, you know, is going to be difficult, and I'm curious to get what their approach was. What was the policy on food, bringing food in? Obviously, I'm assuming that there was no food or drinks being sold at this game. So I'd imagine you got to start allowing people to bring something in.
No, they actually had, and I did not count, but they were probably in that concourse on the side that I was on, somewhere between 8 or 10 concession stands. Only one of them was open for regular food. And then they had another stand that was selling beer, and it looked like it was maybe some booster group or an auxiliary or somebody from the community that was selling that beer. So you could buy, you know, cans of light beer there for $5. So you were paying almost stadium prices for a 12-ounce beer. And I think, I think that was run by some local organization or a collegiate booster group or somewhere where the money was basically a fundraiser. But they had vendors going through the stands.
Oh, really?
Selling it. I mean, again, this is a college game, so it's a little bit of a different twist than what you would have at a pro game. But they had, you know, they were selling soda, they were selling water, they were selling.
See, I can understand that. I can understand like the packaged goods and like the bottled goods, sodas, waters, peanuts.
Well, he did say they were selling cans of soda. Well, they weren't doing draft beers.
Correct.
Right? So yeah, so they're doing canned beers. And stuff
my
like that.
My question would be something that you have to physically handle, like soft pretzels, hot dogs, things like that you actually have to handle. That you're constantly wearing, even if these vendors are wearing gloves. Well, you're touching stuff, you're touching money. There's just so many things that could happen to transmit. Were they doing that? Did you see any like hot dog vendors or?
I didn't see hot dog vendors out in the stands. I think everything that was out in the stands was the prepackaged
goods.
Stuff. Okay. I know that through the announcer, they had at least pizza. They had, quote, the best nachos east of Texas, whatever that means.
Yeah, right.
I did not partake in any of this, so I cannot, you know, confirm nor deny the veracity of that claim.
Right.
So there were some things that, unless they were giving them in a closed cup of nacho sauce and a closed bag of nachos and then a plate for you to pour them out on, which I don't think would make any stab at that claim.
Right.
I did not look that close at exactly what just the quantity of offerings.
I mean, if you're like 30 beers in, it could be the best nachos east of Texas. Right. I mean, if you get those packaged nachos, a little bit of Cheese Whiz, like it could work.
I will tell you right now, and something that was overheard from that group of people in front of me, there were four people in that group that were drinking, and for whatever reason, they kept sending the same guy out to buy beers, and I guess they did not have that two-per rule that we have in the stadiums here.
Oh, yeah. Maryland, you can only do one.
Now, granted, when he was bringing four beers back, he was not drinking four beers. They were being distributed to the group of people that he was with, but he's like, I don't understand why. Like, he didn't put two and two together. He's like, I don't understand why, but they just asked me if I needed somebody to drive me home. Because at the concession stand, they must have thought that this
dude's going.
They're
over-serving this guy.
Plugging four beers at a time and coming back like 15, 20 minutes later, hey, four more.
That's funny. Yeah, Maryland, you can only buy one at a time. You can't even buy a beer for your, you know, significant other,
your
friend,
or anything.
No, you can only buy one at a time. So that's interesting. That's interesting. I was kind of curious because I thought, even from like a professional standpoint, if they were going to have concessions there, were they going to allow people to bring outside food in so that they, you know, there's nobody else handling it? Or if they're going to do concessions at all, it's probably going to be the packaged good stuff, the peanuts, you know, the anything in packaged wrappers.
That's what I was curious on. That's why I asked, because I thought it was – I'm sitting here thinking, you know, we're talking about translating this to the Ravens. I mean, I don't know how the Ravens are going to do that.
Right.
I mean, yeah, you can do peanuts, right? But you can't get the things that are your money makers. Your money makers are your things like it's your crab cakes. It's your pizzas that are there. You know, it's the, you know, the hot dogs and the hamburgers and the chicken nuggets. It's all that stuff.
Right.
It's not your peanuts and your, I don't know, chips, whatever they do now.
Right. That's true. All right, Scott, it's time for this week's Liquor Stop Brew of the Week. And what does the crew have us drinking on today? The can is pretty awesome looking.
Yeah, this is a pretty awesome can. So this is from Stone Brewing Company. This is their Buena Vista.
Pretty cool looking.
So it is a salt and lime lager, 4.7. Again, they just say that it's a lager with salt and lime. They compare it to, they say it's a Mexican-style brew. They tell you
margarita
to,
makes sense.
Yeah, you know, if you, and that's one of the things, you know, I actually tried one of these with my wife last night because she always is curious anytime we don't get an IPA.
right.
So this she had to try this.
Date number one.
She immediately said, this would go great with a margarita.
Yeah, I can see that. I mean, it's not sour. It's not sweet. It's not bitter, really. It's a good blend, I think, of everything.
Well, it's different. I think it's different because when you associate citrus with beer, you're usually thinking oranges, grapefruits, that kind of stuff.
Right.
And you know, maybe a lemon shandy type thing.
Right.
But you don't really think of lime and salt when it comes to that.
Right. What's the alcohol content? 4.7. So it's like of a normal beer or whatever.
Yeah, it's a light.
Yeah.
It's not bad. Is it the first thing I'd reach for? No. But it's if you're sitting outside, nice, you know, somebody. I think this actually might be a good one with crabs. You know, it might be pretty good with crabs because it's a little bit lighter beer. And again, like she said, kind of a margarita. So make sure you guys go up to Liquor Stop, 1510 Conowingo Road. Let them know Birdland BS sent you. Get you 10% off.
All right, Scott, it's time for some bros, bows, and o's. And I don't even know who's left with the o's at this point, right? Guys are flocking the nest left and right as Mike Elias starts making move after move after move. Orioles sit right now at 15-19 overall, fourth in the AL East. Still doing a little bit better, I think, than we would have expected at this point. But, you know, we've been asking for a past couple of weeks with them playing better than expectations. Would the Orioles potentially be trading to go after a playoff bid, or would they still keep the plan as usual and stay on course with building for the future? And I think, obviously, what's happened the last couple of days told
the story.
The
words of the I forget the guy's name, but in the words of the guy that's on TV doing the money show, sell, sell, sell. That's what they were doing this week.
Yeah.
And so a lot of things happening, right? Obviously, we know some of the previous moves that we've talked about. We had, you know, we got some players to be named later through those moves, but the big moves that happened this past week. You had Tommy Malone, first thing Sunday morning, was traded to the Braves for two players to be named later.
I think that's a great move. I mean, this was a guy that you signed right, you know, as spring training was getting ready to wrap up.
To a minor league deal?
Minor league deal. This was not somebody that was even really expected to make a major, you know, any kind of really impact at all. You bring him in and be able to trade him for a bag of balls at this point, I think, is a plus for this team. But to get two players to be named later, we don't know what that means. We don't know what that's going to, you know, equate to. But in fairness, he was traded, and the same day he was traded, he went to Philly for the Braves to play against the Phillies, and he got shelled for 8 earned runs in his first couple of innings there.
I'm sorry, that's on them. That's on the Braves.
I agree.
Because what it was, they wanted him to start that game, and there was worry of whether he was actually going to be able to make it. They were up in Buffalo, remind you, right? Because that's where we're playing the Blue Jays at. They're in Buffalo. He's got to get from Buffalo to Philly to start that night.
Yeah.
You can't do that to a starter. Yeah. Starters have routines.
You've never even played as much as catch with that catcher yet. The catcher knows nothing about you.
If you're talking a reliever, that's a little bit different story.
Right.
Right? They're coming in for an inning or two at the most and going. But when you're talking your starter,
right,
to go, okay, you get off a plane and you're starting,
yeah,
you can't do that to these guys. These guys are creatures of habit. It absolutely cannot happen. That's all on the Braves. Or
agreed,
their mishandling of that. They lost a game because they got antsy in not wanting to have to adjust and change their rotation for one day.
Right.
Sorry.
Right.
Bring somebody up from your practice squad and let them go.
Right.
Like, you might as well have done that rather than rush Tommy Malone. Because you also could have risked injury doing that.
Yeah.
He hasn't stretched fully. He hasn't had his full day of routine to in order to start.
It's a lot to ask of anybody,
yeah,
and especially such short notice. And, again, not having any kind of rhythm with the team, not having any kind of rhythm with the catcher. It's a lot to ask. And you're going against the Phillies lineup who has 6 or 7 all-stars, yeah, riddled through that lineup. That's a tall task for anybody. But a couple of bullpen arms that got moved over the last couple of days, too. A couple of guys that we thought might be trade chips.
Right.
Michael Givens. This one kind of tugged at the heartstrings a little bit. Because, I mean, Michael Givens, as much as I don't think he's a closer, and I've said that, and I don't think he's a good closer, and I don't know why the Orioles have put him in a closing role, I do think he's a good middle reliever, right? And I've watched him come up from the time that he was drafted when he was with Aberdeen as a shortstop. Couldn't figure it out, and then they trade him over to a pitcher, and he comes up, and he does well for a few years. I mean, his career, he had like a low 3 ERA in his time here.
It was a reverse Nick Markakis.
Right.
You know, when he comes up, he's doing well, and the problem is when they tried to expand and change his role. He immediately settled into that, you know, that setup man type role. He was a double setup man. You know, he would come in either the 7th or the 8th. He did well, set your closer up.
Right.
When you tried to push him into closer, that didn't work. Then what did they do? They tried to pull him in earlier in games and making him a long reliever. That didn't work.
Yeah.
You should have never have messed with him there. But we get the guys. We get him, you know, for a player to be named later and the two infielders.
They're not just two infielders.
No, they're not.
These are two very good, highly rated prospects. I mean, this was Taron Vavra, the middle infielder, was the Rockies' number 7 overall prospect. Go ahead. Tyler Nevin, son of Phil Nevin, was their number 13 overall prospect. Like, these are two guys that are pretty damn good and are almost major league ready, that could be ready to contribute to this club in the next year or two.
Yeah, these guys that were already producing.
Right.
You're going to put them in the minors, see how they're doing, and then bring them up if you need to.
Right.
But they're going to be ready sooner rather than later. So it's great to see these guys come in.
Yep. And then your boy,
Miguel Castro, gets traded. He gone. He goes to the Mets. I have to say, despite my like for Castro, I like this trade.
I do too.
This to me.
I like all three of these trades.
I like all three of them. This to me was the best one. Because you get a starter in Kevin Smith, left-handed starter.
Yeah.
This kid, and a player to be named later, by the way. Kevin Smith, who's 23 years old. He's the Mets' number 12 prospect in the MLB pipeline.
Yep.
Now, with this kid, he is 6'5". He reached double-A in Binghamton last year.
Yep.
Right? And we've seen many guys that other teams and other organizations be able to do in double-A and then turn around and translate it to the majors. We've seen it.
Right.
This is a guy I expect them to bring him up on the expanded roster, potentially latter portion of the season,
right?
Maybe the last few weeks, just to see what he can do, let him get a few innings in. But expect this guy to make an impact next year.
This is a guy that pitched at the University of Georgia, pitched out of their bullpen for pretty much his entire career out of there, Georgia. In 2019, last year, he started high A. He had 17 starts there, 5-5, a 3.05 ERA, 1.249 whip. He then gets promoted to Double A, as you said. That's kind of where he capped out. 6 starts, 3-2, 3.45 ERA, 1.277 WHIP. So pretty consistent, high A to Double A. And they say that, you know, a lot of times taking a jump from Double A to the majors isn't as significant as some might think. Triple A is more for like the development and bringing guys down and or stacking your roster, you know, with your
Beyond
the 25, it's the guys that are there, your insurance policy, right?
Yeah, exactly.
Your true talent, your true young youth is usually in that high A, double A ball. And I think this guy was able to perform at both of those levels so far.
Yeah, he's shown that he can do it. I'm really excited to see this and see what he's going to be able to bring to this team.
Yeah.
The only concern I have with all of this, and it's a concern for me, and I'm curious to get everybody here's take. This is now the sixth player to be named later that the Orioles have gotten through trades.
Mm-hmm.
Now, listen, I like Elias. He hasn't given me any reason not to trust him. But player to be named later is such a broad term.
It's a broad term, but it's...
There's no, like, as far as I know, there is no, like... Okay, that player needs to be at this level.
No,
or they need to be at that level.
The way I understand that it works, it's negotiated based on how their impact is, right? So if that's why I was saying Tommy Malone, right? He goes in, he gets shelled for 8 runs right away. That's not a good start with the Braves. But if he goes in there and he cleans things up and he has a good impact on that squad, it then gives the Orioles more bargaining chip to be able to get a better player to be named later.
But if he doesn't, it hurts us.
It doesn't necessarily hurt us because these are guys that the Orioles were going to have to give up anyway. These are guys that, again, weren't part of the Orioles' future. The Miguel Castro trade, you got a good piece in beyond the player to be named later, right? The player to be named later is I kind
There's
of
There's got
like
to be like a list
sugar.
Of players that like, here's the guys that
and
we
I'm
are
sure
willing
there is.
To accept.
Jobeth, I mean, you would understand that, right?
I don't know firsthand because I don't know firsthand because I don't do, obviously, any of this within baseball, but it's my understanding that there is a grouping of it's going to be out of this batch of guys or this range of guys. So behind the scenes, and it's not going to be announced to the general public, there is a range and a short list of guys that are going to be this player to be named later.
Right.
And some of that is going to have to be, and there may, and I don't know how detailed this gets, but it some of it does have to do with how those guys develop and where they are at the time that that trade finalizes.
Right. Yeah. Agreed.
Brian, you're a baseball guy. What do you think of these trades and the fact that, you know, we're getting so many guys that are in that position of player to be named later?
I like it because, you know, I mean, in my opinion, you're just looking towards the future, and that's the most exciting part to me with all these pickups and players that being named later. It does scare me, though, that it's kind of like there's nobody out there right now that we're eyeing up, but maybe down the line.
Right.
But
I think Joeth makes a good point. I do think, and I think you bring up a good point, too, is there's got to be some sort of internal structure beyond just Baseball America and ranking system, right? And Drew brings up a good point. He says, not my theory, but I think player to be named later is – can you move that off there so I can read it? is a big thing this year because there's no farm system grades, right? That's a good point, right? That this year it's kind of – going to go based off of what they've done in the past, 2019, because you have nothing to grade them on as to how they're doing right now.
Right.
So if they agreed to whatever those rankings are, that player to be named later is your 15th to 25th prospect, depending upon how they finish out for the year. That means you're going to get somewhere between 15 and 25, which I don't think is a bad deal.
The other thing is the question, like, I mean, I know, and it obviously can change. Are you going to say it needs to be at one of these two positions, right? Or is it like, there's just so many things up in the air that's why it makes me uneasy because you
it's
don't.
The unknown.
It's the unknown, and you don't know what you're going to get. Are you going to get a guy? You know, if it's on this list of players, what if that guy is starting to have some fall off because he's not getting the games, right?
Right.
And he that messes with his confidence, and all of a sudden now here's a guy you thought you were getting something better than what you actually are. Now, I get that can happen any other year, but the fact that it's this year and there nothing is certain this year, I would want something certain for what I'm giving up this year.
Yeah.
Because I know what I have in a lot of these guys. it makes me uneasy a little bit. I'll see what happens. I'll see what comes out of all this.
I trust in Elias, man. I think he's done a great job since he's been here. I don't question the moves that he's making.
He hasn't given me any reason. It just makes me uneasy when you see it, and it really comes down to I want to know what I'm getting. I want something tangible, and right now it's not tangible, and I don't know when it's going to be tangible either.
Right.
So that's the hard as a fan. That's what's hard to chew on because you don't know what's coming. You right. don't know what you're getting for it. But it's one of those things that you're looking at the future.
Right.
Right. But let's take a second and let's look now.
Yeah.
Because a guy that we have been really high on, been loving that he's been up here,
yep.
has been Ryan Mountcastle.
Yeah, man. Had a huge, huge game. He's had a huge impact since he's been here.
Yeah.
We talked about it last week. You know, the question mark that he had as far as the bat goes was his selection, his pitch selection, and not being able to take pitches and not being able to walk and get on bases. Well, he's been able to do that.
Yeah.
And then some. Everything that we didn't question was his ability to make contact, his ability to hit the ball a long way. And he was able to do that two times on Sunday as he hit his first two major league home runs against the Blue Jays. Up in Buffalo, in a minor league stadium, nonetheless. His two first major league home runs are in a minor league stadium. Kind of funny. But they were absolutely no doubters.
They were bombs. He hit these two a total of 830 feet.
Yeah.
Right? Crazy. So 415 a pop. That's pretty damn good.
Even Ryan, you know, our Terps B-Espert out there, Texas in the group, he's like, you know, I'm not the biggest of baseball fans. But, you know, he had been watching and he saw the highlights of Ryan Mountcastle. He said, man, this kid's swing, he's not saying it's Griffey, you know, it's like Griffey, but it's got a similar smoothness to it and it's got a similar result in obviously being able to hit the ball a long way.
It's Griffey, yes. Go ahead, James.
Do you think that ball goes in the Hall of Fame for being a major league home run in a minor league ballpark?
A major Ooh. League home run in a minor
It is a significant,
ballpark.
But the problem is, so that's, I get what he's saying. So it's the first home run that was hit during a major league game being played at a minor league ballpark during
the
regular
season.
I don't
think there's ever been.
No. I mean, they've been playing in Buffalo since the season started.
No, I know that, but I'm just saying his first home run.
His first career home run. A first career home run.
You're saying a first career home run. Okay. I don't know if it goes in the Hall of Fame. But
if he makes it, it will.
Irony enough, it was like a 70-year-old man in a pirate shirt that went out there and got the ball, which was absolutely
hilarious. I forgot to say something to my boss today because he's a huge Pittsburgh Pirates fan. I want to be like, was that you out there? Was that you out there?
It was funny.
No, but I don't know if you've ever been to the Hall of Fame, but I've been in. They have unique stuff there.
No, they absolutely do. Yeah. I don't know. That's a good question. They could end up in the Hall of Fame because, I don't know how that works.
Yeah, but let's look at it this way. Either way, those balls were crushed, right? To give people a perspective, so my seats, I sit right behind the wall in left field behind the 364 mark, yep. right? So my
about what, eight rows back?
Four rows back. Okay. So it's about 8 feet, okay. right? So at that point, you add that, we're now at 372. If you keep going, these balls traveled on average the equivalent of hitting the back row
of the lower deck. That's impressive. That's really impressive for his first two.
And I'm not just talking the back row over by the foul pole.
Right.
I'm talking the back row of my section, which is one section over from the bullpen. This went that deep. It was a bomb.
Yeah. Like I said, there's no questioning what he can do with the bat. I think this has been something that's been waiting to be seen now for 2 years. Everybody's been itching to see Ryan Mountcastle. It's been, what's he going to be able to do defensively? And so far, out in left field, I haven't seen anything as far as looking like a liability. Does he look a little, not lost, but does he look like he takes bad routes at times? Yes. There are definitely fundamental things that he needs to clean up in his game. But for them to hold him down that long because they were worried about his defensive ability, either he's really put in the time and he's gotten better, or I just don't see it. I don't see it as being a glaring issue.
I think he's put in the time, one. Number two, it didn't help that they were bouncing him around because you didn't know where you were going. I mean, think about this. We were talking just a few weeks ago about, well, if you bring him up, where are you going to put him? You're going to put him at first base? You're going to put him at third base? You're going to put him in the outfield?
Right.
You're going to put him in left field? You're going to put him in right field? Like, we were just talking about this just a few weeks ago. So for them, he's been playing. It was, where are we going to put him?
You know, is he going to be able to handle the speed at the major league level? The bad routes, a bad route in the major leagues, you see it way easier
right
than you do at the, you know, the minor league level. So that's where I think it comes in, is that he needed to be more comfortable and had to be to a point. They had to be to a point with him. He had to be to a point with them where he could openly say, I feel comfortable out here. It's not necessarily a foreign territory anymore.
Right.
You know, if I can at least get the right routes, being able to round on the ball, you know, playing balls off the wall. Nick Markakis, we were spoiled.
Yeah.
Nick Markakis was one of the best there is.
I mean, Markakis and Adam Jones, we were spoiled by outfield play for a very long time.
We were. But specifically off the wall. And for a left fielder, if you're going to put somebody in left field, what's the biggest thing they need to be comfortable with in this division? A wall.
Oh, yeah, right.
You need to know how to play it, because that wall out there, the wall itself is not 300 feet.
Right.
The wall itself is like 280, 270. You've got that up. You've got to learn how to play that ball that normally you're tracking down.
Right.
You've got to learn how to play that off the wall.
Yeah.
You've got to.
But you can only do that with experience. You can only do that by getting up there and getting the reps and getting the experience. So I'm glad he's here. I think he's here to stay at this point. There has been nothing about his game that shows me that, you know, there's any concern about him not being able to perform at this level.
I'll tell you one thing I was concerned about, and it wound up coming back to bite us. Cobb's last outing.
Yeah, yeah. He's looked rough the last two outings.
I think that hurt his trade value.
It could have. Yeah, he was one of the pieces that I was kind of surprised didn't get moved. Alex Cobb, Jose Iglesias, who's been a very good chip for us. I know he's had some injury issues.
Yeah.
Yeah, but when he's played, he's been good. So I was surprised nobody came knocking for him. There was just a couple of pieces that I thought might get moved that didn't. But at the end of the day, it's definitely been the pitching that has reverted back to kind of what we expected this pitching staff to be, that's kind of put us – on this losing trail that we've been going down for the last few, last week, two weeks, really.
Yeah, it's been bad the past few weeks. And the other guy that's really just making my brain start to hurt, and it's actually, he's not making my brain hurt, it's Brandon Hyde that's making my brain hurt, and maybe it's because he feels like he doesn't have anybody else. Like, who else are you going to put out there?
Right.
I think there are a few names, but Cole Sulcer, you know, we were high on him. He looked good. Yeah.
Look good for just, a couple weeks.
Yeah, but he has just fallen off the table. He has now blown his third save, and he had his fourth loss of the season.
Yeah. The Orioles just don't have a ton of arms down in the bullpen right now. They did get Hunter Harvey back, which he's now in the pen. We talked about it before. I like Tanner Scott more in that closing role. I think he's the closer of the future, in my opinion. Between him and Hunter Harvey,
I think he's the setup.
The setup closer. They just got to kind of figure that out. If Hunter Harvey can stay healthy, that's been his problem his entire career. So it's going to be interesting to see what happens for the remaining portion of this year, because they've got guys that they're just pulling in. Jorge Lopez, who the hell is this guy? Comes in out of nowhere, didn't pitch too terribly. I mean, he gave up a couple of walks, but he had three strikeouts and 4 2/3 in his first outing with us. Didn't do too bad.
Yeah, it's his first true start, so to speak. He's coming in long relief, but his first true start. And, for 4 2/3, I mean, like you mentioned it, 3 runs, 3 hits, 3 walks, and 3 strikeouts.
Yeah.
A lot of threes.
Noticing a pattern.
Except for the 4 2/3.
Right.
But at the same time, it's not bad. Yeah, it's 3 runs. That's what hurts him. But 3 runs off of 3 hits? They were just squaring up the ball.
Right.
That's all that was happening.
Well, let me ask you, are you bought in and are you okay with everything that's happened, the moves, staying the course as far as developing and building for the future and not pushing all the chips in and trying to go after this 60-game championship that you were talking about at the beginning of the year?
Yeah, I mean, I was the one that was the beginning of the year saying I didn't want to trade away the house. I didn't think, I didn't think you were trading away guys like Santander and Nunez and Alberto, who we heard, winds up having a little bit of, knee stiffness tonight and is out for the next two games. But these are guys that you can build somewhat of a little bit more of an immediate future around, and then develop those guys into guys that maybe in a year or two, they become guys that you can trade for high-value pieces for your farm system that can come up and make that impact. If your goal is 3 years from now, maybe these are the guys that help you get those pieces. Or, better yet, maybe these are the guys that are the pieces and can help you long term. Maybe the pieces are a little bit more in front of us than we think.
Right.
Just saying. Yes, development is a piece of it, but he's using what we already had, and he's doing well with it.
Right.
I got to give Elias credit on that.
Yeah, no, that's true. All right, so last thing I want to ask you, about the Ryan Mountcastle situation. Obviously, so far, I mean, he's tearing the cover off the ball. He's got the two home runs. He's got two doubles, five RBIs. Patience, like I said, he's got the four walks so far. The one thing that has been an issue has been strikeouts down in the minor leagues, and that's continued up here. He's got eight or nine of them, I think, now at this point.
Yeah.
Do you think that the league will adjust and he'll go through his struggles, or do you think this is kind of what we expect from Ryan Mountcastle moving forward?
If he continues with his patience, I think it's what you can expect because he's being selective.
Right.
Right. Yes, the eight strikeouts are there. Those are swing and misses. It's developmental for him with that. Right. That's part of the reason you're also bringing him up this year is to get the major league at bats and show, yes, I can do this at the major league level on a consistent basis.
Right.
And I tell you what, all those numbers you just read off are through nine games. I know it's small, but it's through 33 at bats. The kid's hitting .364 and has an OPS of 1.038. Not a lot of guys at the major league level that nine games into their career can say they're hitting .364.
It's true. All right, Brian, it's time for a social media shout-out. Who's been out there? Who's chiming in? Anything good?
So we got Drew, Steve, or Steven, Justin, Joe Cardozo, and Ryan Schammel. Okay. So Nick brought up a question. Can you see Dez setting the edge as a pass rusher? Sorry, I had to sneak either A.B. or Dez Bryant talking here.
Our
boy is not out there chiming it up about the A.B. talk. So
right.
Somebody's got to step it up for him. He says, I have a good – speaking of Drew, he also brought this one. He says, I have a real good feeling about Boykin this year. What's your guys' take? Do you think he has, like, a bust-out season, or you think it might be kind of a disappointment?
No, I think this is the year that Boykin comes into his own. We talked about it last week. I think he needs to show with his size at 6'4", 220, that he can be a physical wide receiver and that he can be relied on to be that jump ball guy, to be that red zone target that we expected him to be out of Notre Dame. Listen, and there's not to say that this guy can't be more than that. He's got 4.4 speed. He's got the ability to make plays with his feet as well. It's just, I think really last year it came down to a confidence thing, both in himself because early on he had a couple of drops which are completely unexpected. He wasn't a guy who had any questions about his hands coming out of college. He had a couple of drops. Lamar kind of looked the other way and didn't have a whole lot of confidence in him after that, but I think that changes going into this year.
I think it has to change, you know, two reasons. One, because you can't go another year with having this guy who's a high-value guy that you can't have him not producing.
Right.
Because in all reality, he didn't produce last year. The other thing that you got to do is Lamar is your quarterback of the future. You've got to have him be confident in him.
Right.
If Lamar is not confident in Boykin, that is a major red flag.
Yeah.
Because you're trying to build this offense around him. If he's not comfortable and not willing to throw to him, you might as well assume every red zone target you're going to put him in, the ball's not coming to him.
Right.
And guess what? If we're assuming it, every other defense out there is.
All right, Scott, it's time for the rundown. We're getting kind of long on this show here, so we're going to speed through some of this. But one thing I don't want to speed through is some sad news happened. Just the other day, as Georgetown legendary basketball coach, men's basketball coach, John Thompson passed away at the age of 78. This is a guy that I grew up a Georgetown fan basketball. Grew up a Georgetown basketball fan because my uncle was a big basketball Georgetown fan. So my first college basketball game was a Georgetown Hoyas game, and this was back in the 90s when they had...
Oh, I thought you were going to say back when Patrick Ewing was playing.
No. This was in the 90s when they had Allen Iverson, they had Alonzo Mourning. I mean, this guy, he coached some of the biggest names. I mean, you mentioned Patrick Ewing, you know, Hakeem Olajuwon, or not Hakeem Olajuwon.
Dikembe Mutombo,
Dikembe Mutombo. I get those two guys mixed up. Dikembe Mutombo, Alonzo Mourning, Allen Iverson. I mean, this is when Georgetown was in their heyday of being one of the biggest basketball programs in the country.
And if you haven't seen it, it's been all over because one of the biggest stories that just kind of – it really shows you what he was about as a human,
yeah.
right? is the Allen Iverson Hall of Fame speech.
Yeah.
Right? Because if not for John Thompson, Allen Iverson owes his entire career, and in Allen Iverson's words, his life, to John Thompson.
Yeah.
I have not seen anything. I also haven't been trying to look because I don't want to know. I don't know where this puts Allen Iverson mentally.
Yeah.
Just because this is somebody that was near and dear to his heart.
Yeah.
John Thompson gave him a shot. If you haven't heard the story, the quick synopsis. Everybody else, AI had some issues, some off the court issues,
yeah,
and some education issues. And every major school was turning him down, saying, "We don't want anything to do with you anymore." His mom, AI's mom, went to John Thompson and asked him for him to give him a shot.
Give him a chance.
And he did.
Yep.
And look at what happened.
Yeah. Had a Hall of Fame career out of it.
Yeah. And so he truly owes it. I think it just shows you what he is. And let's not forget, you kind of mentioned he's the first black head coach to win a national championship.
Yeah,
right?
1984.
So it just goes to show you. He also, the other story that I keep hearing, especially in the times that we are in, is when he walked off the court for Prop 42.
Right.
Right. Prop 42, if you don't know what that was back when they were trying to do some things where the proposition actually hurt players that were coming from low-income families, low-income areas,
right,
and low-education areas. It hurt them, and he walked off the court and said, "I'm not going to be here if this is going to pass." And right, guess what? It didn't. Because of him, he had that impact, right, which is why people are bringing him in now with everything that's going on out there. But his overall impact to the game of basketball, you know, think about the guys that we mentioned off.
Yeah.
Almost all of those guys are Hall of Fame basketball players.
Yeah.
Yep. I think he had one. Well, I think they said he had one or two losing seasons.
Yeah, and he left a legacy with his son. His son coached Georgetown for a very long time as well. So our thoughts and well wishes with the Thompson family and everybody, you know, all his friends that were impacted by this loss. Again, a legendary coach in college basketball history. But let's talk a little bit of NFL, right?
Yeah.
There's some recent rumors. Actually, it happened just a couple hours before we went live today. There have been some rumblings about some running backs in the NFL that are not too happy with their contract situation. And one of which,
Alvin Kamara,
apparently the Saints are open to trade discussions with the Pro Bowl running back. This, in my opinion, I don't know. Just talking short term, just talking this year, right? Which he's still under contract for this year. I don't know how many more years you have left of Drew Brees. I think this might be one of Drew Brees' last, or maybe he's holding on a little too long, right? So your window for winning is small, right? Your window is winning for is small. I'm not one that says you should pay running backs top-tier money. I said this prior to the season. I thought that running back was one of those positions where you get them in their prime the first 4 or 5 years of their contract on that rookie deal, use them, abuse them, and let somebody else pay for it, right? But the Saints are in a unique situation where I don't know how much time they have left with Drew Brees, and I don't know how much time they have left to be a true Super Bowl contender. And I can tell you now, you take Alvin Kamara out of the mix, you're not going to be in the thick for a Super Bowl, in my opinion.
I agree. I think the one thing I would say into Kamara's defense of why he's going at this is exactly what you just said, right? Don't pay running backs long term. Let somebody else pay him, right? Use them and abuse them. That's the one thing, is the running backs have a shorter career on average.
Right.
And because of that, they get used and abused, but they don't get, they very rarely see the true compensation. Unless you are a top 10,
right,
you're not truly going to see that compensation for all the grunt work that you are somewhat doing in a lot of these offensive systems. There's 32 NFL teams. There are not 32 top paid running backs. Even if they do that, a lot of that, we're seeing this trend. You're seeing these rookies go off the chain there for a few years, and then they die off because they're getting hurt.
Right. Well, right. The running back position has one of the shortest shelf lives in the NFL. But my point is, with Alvin Kamara, right, if you know your window is small as far as winning, that might be my exception to say, all right, I might work out a 2, maybe 3-year extension for somebody like this if I know my winning the Super Bowl window is in the next 2 to 3 years. I don't know if Alvin Kamara is going to commit to that. He might want a five-year extension, like an Ezekiel Elliott-type deal, like Dalvin Cook is trying to get out in Minnesota. Like a lot of these running backs that are at the end of their rookie deals are trying to get. And if that's the case, then maybe you do. Maybe this is the best move for the Saints, because do you want to commit top three running back money, which is good money, to a piece when you don't even know what the future of your quarterback's going to be beyond next year?
Yeah.
Quarterback to me, and we've said this, I've said this a million times, is the biggest difference maker on a professional sports team in any sport. If you've got a good quarterback, everything else around you is better.
Yeah. I mean, you have to have a, it's a little bit different because we're spoiled with Lamar right now, but you have to, if you don't have a guy that can run, you need to have a running game.
No, I get that. I understand that. But what I'm saying is Alvin Kamara himself with an average quarterback, to me, doesn't win a Super Bowl. I think Alvin Kamara paired with Drew Brees for this next two, maybe 3 years, if they can get that much out of him, makes them a legitimate Super Bowl team or a contender every year. They have a chance.
Yeah, I mean, I get your point. I get what you're saying. I think it's just hard to say because I get Kamara's why he's holding out, and they're probably just done with the arguments, and it's probably, well, if you're not going to pay me, then I ain't playing.
Right.
So they're saying, okay, well, if you're not playing, then we're going to trade your ass.
Well, let me ask you this, Jeremy. What's your take on players holding out like this when they feel like they need better value or more money for what they're producing on the field? Like, what's your take on that?
Well, I mean, it's part of the process, and with each CBA, they seem to put more poison pills in there for the players and ways for them to be penalized for holding out, but you still see it happen.
Right.
And, I mean, at the end of the day, there are certain positions that unless you're really special, a lot of teams tend to let those guys go.
Right.
And let somebody else play them, pay them. Some do, some don't. It really varies. At the end of the day, I mean, it's still a business, and it's a business on both sides of the team and the player. And as of right now, from my understanding, there has not been a request to be released or traded from the player or his agent.
Right. Yeah.
And the Saints have said that they're open to it, but I think he's just trying to renegotiate this deal.
Right.
And he's not particularly happy with where he is right now, but. Again, we see guys go into that, hey, I can renegotiate this deal. One of them may have recently been released by the Ravens that want to renegotiate now because they know that the injury quotient in this league is so high year in, year out at almost every position that they don't want to end up being carted off the field mid-season when they didn't get that deal.
Right.
Yeah. And speaking of guys getting released, right? Let's talk Jacksonville for a second.
Yeah.
This tanking for Trevor, hashtag tanking for Trevor.
I mean, how else do you explain it?
It doesn't, right? So they not only do they trade Yannick, who is, you guys have talked about, he is a top tier or on his way to be a top tier, if he's not already, defensive player, defensive end. And then you turn around and you release Fournette.
Yeah, Fournette.
You're just fueling the fire on this.
That's on top. You're missing even more. I mean, the Ravens got Calais Campbell for a fifth-round pick. Jalen Ramsey was traded to the Rams last year. They unloaded all their potential big-money tickets, all their guys that they were going to have to pay big money.
And there's one more. There's one more thing that came out this week.
What's that?
Guess who they're potentially trying to get and sway to be a head coach next year?
Don't know.
Dabo Swinney.
Oh, wow.
Swinney and Lawrence, all in one shot. You get Swinney to input his system in here with the quarterback that he knows.
How many times have we seen college coaches fail when they take the jump to the NFL?
But
many times?
The difference is today's NFL is showing that the college game, like a Lamar, you're starting to be able to translate some of that.
I mean, yes and no. It's still a different game, and there's
it's a different speed.
Yeah, and you're talking about kids and developing kids versus professionals, athletes. It's a totally different mindset. It's a totally different personality. That's why certain coaches can't deal with those types of personalities. It's why it doesn't work. And let's be honest, some of these big, big coaches, like the Dabo Sweeneys, like the Nick Sabans, like, they are gods in where they are, and they're making boatloads of money. Literally, money's just coming in boats to them. I don't understand the appeal of the NFL for some of these head coaches that are coming out of college, because if it's purely financial, there's not a financial benefit, in my opinion, going from college to the NFL. If it's anything, it's more so a bucket list thing. Like, not my goal is to be an NFL head coach, and that's why I'd pursue it. If I'm Dabo Sweeney, he is Clemson. He is everything that Clemson is right now. He is king shit in Clemson. I'm staying my ass there.
Yeah, I mean, I don't disagree with you, but I also look at the fact and say, look, it's going in. The NFL is changing. Yes, I agree with you. But to go in with the guy, if you can say, hey, if we get first pick, we got the guy that you already know.
Right.
You guys can develop your system around this. And while they may not, the Jags may even recognize that it's going to be a development, it's going to be a rebuild. Let's think about this. If you're going to do something with the rebuild, why not do it with a college coach who can mentor and train? If you're going to I'm not saying Sweeney is going to win you a championship, but I am going to tell you he's going to be able to develop young guys, right? He's been able to do it.
Right.
Who knows if you can get some of these other guys with it too? I think it really comes down to it. James.
Yeah, real quick. There's a lot of college coaches in the league right now. You got Arizona.
Yeah, Cliff Kingsbury. I know that there are some.
And then you got the new one for North Carolina.
Matt Rhule.
Oh, Matt Rhule, right, which we haven't seen success yet. It's still too early.
It's going to come. The league is changing.
But we've seen it. We've seen it time and time again.
It's all old. Pete Carroll has proved it wrong.
Pete Carroll's the exception, not the norm when it comes to college coaches, though.
Yeah, it's rare. It's my rare. Point. The percentages
Bill
are
O'Brien.
Really? Bill O'Brien. That's your example.
He's still in the league.
Nick Saban, he's still in the league, though.
That if he's still in the league, that says more about the Texans organization than it does about Bill O'Brien.
I mean, who did he trade? His all-star wide receiver? Why? Yeah. Because they didn't see eye to eye.
Listen, get rid of Clowney.
I'm not saying that he would be.
It sounds like John Harbaugh too.
I'm not saying he'd be a failure in the NFL, but what I'm saying is, look at the bigger picture here, right? It's not a financial gain for them to do it. The amount of money that he's making in college and all that, it's not a financial gain. And again, he is God where he is. He won't be God. He'll be judged. And the minute he doesn't win a football game in Jacksonville, they'll be yelling for him to get the fuck out of there, too, just like they do with everybody else.
There's nothing to yell down there.
Here's another college coach I'll bring up to you that lost his luster when he went to the NFL, Steve Spurrier. He went and became the head coach of the Redskins, and then he tried going back to college. Doesn't have that same luster
anymore.
Hanging,
just like he hung his hat on Bill O'Brien, you're hanging your hat on the Washington Redskins.
Hey, I'm just saying.
The Washington football team.
Yeah,
sorry.
Whatever the hell they're calling themselves now.
I get Fred's point. I guess what I'm saying is
not saying he can't be successful.
No, but the thing that's in his favor is his quarterback coming into the same system. We've never seen that.
Well, Cliff Kingsbury is doing it now in Arizona.
Correct.
Kyler Murray.
Right. Look at the potential success they're already having.
Yeah.
Right?
Right.
Kyler Murray is going to be there. So I think Ryan said that was the test, too. So if that truly does work out there in Arizona, what does it hurt for Jacksonville to do it? I know you're saying for Sweeney.
No. I'm looking at it from Dabo's perspective.
Right.
I'm not looking at it from Jacksonville. Of course, Jacksonville is trying to get anybody with any kind of significant name out there because nobody wants to fucking go to Jacksonville right now.
Right.
And they're just dumping players left and right, right? So they're trying to get a 2-for-1 package deal, Sweeney and Lawrence, right? They're obviously tanking. But again, if I'm Dabo and I'm just looking bigger picture, it's not a financial gain for me and everybody loves me here. I'm in the thick of things for national championships every single year. I don't think I'm going anywhere. That's just me. That's my perspective on it.
Yeah, it depends on his ability. I don't know what he's got built around him as far as recruiting and stuff like that. Recruiting, I mean, it takes a lot of time, right? Yeah. There is no offseason. There's an offseason in football. I get in NFL. I get that. But there is truly in college football, there's truly no offseason. You're doing nothing but recruiting all the time.
Yeah.
So that's the benefit from
it. They got a whole lot of time right now.
Yeah, a whole lot.
Two-minute warning.
All right, Fred. It's time for the two-minute warning this week.
That it is.
You called dibs before the show and made me go first.
That's right.
So we couldn't have fun with that.
Noticing a trend.
Yeah, right? So, all right. So I think we got Brian asking one question. And I think you've got our second question, right? All right. So,
All right.
Go ahead, Brian. Get us started.
All righty. So who would you rather build a team around? San Diego Padres shortstop Fernando Tatis Jr. or Los Angeles outfielder Mike Trout?
So for me, it's got to be the experience of Mike Trout. With Mike Trout, what you're getting, you know what you're getting. Tatis has been doing great, right? But he still has a lot to prove. Mike Trout has proved it year after year after year after year after year. Do you see what I'm doing here?
Yeah. I'm noticing the trend.
Yeah. So there's a reason I would build around Mike Trout. Now, if I can afford it, I'm bringing over Fernando Tatis.
I always say you're building up the middle, right? And both of these guys factor into that, center field or shortstop. If you're talking about riding the hot player right now for one season, it's Fernando Tatis. But if you're talking about building for the future and building a franchise around, it's Mike Trout. Mike Trout is going to go down as one of the best players to ever play this game.
Yeah.
The comparisons from him to Bo Jackson as far as athleticism, I get it. Fernando Tatis is doing amazing things right now. But I think the long-term benefit of Trout would far exceed.
Yeah. Good job.
All right, so you guys saw the pictures in the stadium. You saw the layout of the fans and everything like that. If we get 2, 3, 4 weeks into the season, I know you guys normally go to Ravens games, but one of those things about those games is the environment.
Right.
Seeing what you saw earlier today, here's 2 tickets to the next game that they're allowed to have fans in. Are you in? And one thing that we didn't talk about earlier, no tailgating.
Can I have the ticket now? I'll be there. I will be there. Like, no doubt about it. We have been craving live sports. I will do anything. If I got to wear a mask the whole time, I'll wear a mask. If I got to, you know, be 6 feet away from Fred, I'd rather be 6 feet away than sitting this close.
Yeah, like I said, it looked like there was 10 fans in the stands. If that's what the social distancing is going to look like in an NFL stadium, I'm 100% on board with that. Would I like to be tailgating and all that stuff because that's what the part of the experience is for me? Of course. But if it means that I'm going to be able to get to watch live football with that type of exposure, 100% sign me up. I'm for it. Definitely. All right, Scott, sign us out, man.
All right, guys. We appreciate each of you guys coming in each and every week. Make sure you check out us on our website, www.birdlandbs.com. While you're there, you can check out all of our episodes. Make sure you leave us a comment. Get yourself some Birdland BS gear. Check out the Shell and Tell podcast.
Yeah.
You guys have been putting out some new stuff. Not a whole lot, considering there's not a lot going on.
Not
in
a lot
college
going on. But we're going to get
football.
Something out here shortly.
Exactly. Make sure you also follow us, BigPlay.com. Download the Big Play app, Big Play Twitter page. Make sure you also check us out on BirdlandSports.com as well. All of our social media pages, it's easy to find us, at BirdlandBS. If it's Facebook, YouTube, Instagram, Snapchat, Twitter, go find us at BirdlandBS. For Fred, at FredBLBS, at ScottBLBS. Brian at Bartender_Blake. We have the Church of Yes out there. We forgot
James
on the show.
He's a new one.
And then James is also on there. Make sure you go follow all of us while you're there. Make sure you also listen to the audio version of the podcast. Spotify, iTunes, Google Podcasts, wherever you're at. Make sure you give us a thumbs up. Make sure you give us a review. It helps us get found when people are looking for podcasts to listen to. So make sure you go do that as soon as you listen to the show. As always, we thank you guys for tuning in each and every
big
week.
Thank you to our guest, Jobeth Bauer, for coming in again for our second show together. Hope to have you out here again. We appreciate your insight, man.
A lot of
sure.
people were saying they loved the investigative reporting. They felt like you were investigating reporting for the show. I love it.
That was the plan going into it. I figured that it was something that people were going to be interested in. Let's do it. I'm going to be there anyway.
There you go, man. All right, so we'll see you guys next Tuesday night, 7:30 Eastern Standard Time. Facebook, YouTube, Instagram, Snapchat. We're on all of them. Go check us out. See you guys.
See ya. For the after party.
Slash call for alcohol. James, what happened to my other shot I asked you for like an hour ago?
I didn't get it because I was too busy looking at the feed on the phone. So it popped up.
No, he was too busy trying to draft his like fourth tight end is what he was doing.
I kept hearing background noise. I'm like, where is this talking coming from? I couldn't figure it out. He was on his phone with the mic on.
No, but it was turned off. The volume's off.
Somebody's was on.
Yeah, I kept hearing it.
Whatever. Either way.
It wasn't me, but what I kept hearing was that fish tank over there. Somewhere deep in the ether, I could hear the water bubbling in that fish tank.
All right, so we got to get that filled up.
I'll get it filled up.
Hey, man, so we had our Birdland BS fantasy draft over the weekend, which was a lot of fun. Got to see everybody. It was kind of cool to, you know, bring everybody together through. This is like the one time this year that we've been able to do that, you know?
Yeah.
With all the restrictions that we have in this world.
We were social distance for the most part.
We did a good job with all that, but it was a lot of fun. James' draft was
interesting
to say the least, as it always is. For you fantasy fans out there, James took the best tight end in the league in Travis Kelce in the second round, followed by the second best tight end in the league, in George Kittle in the third round, back-to-back tight ends.
And then in the eighth and ninth round, he took back-to-back defenses.
Yeah, back-to-back defenses. Now, he did get Lamar. He did get Lamar in the first round.
He's pouring a shot, so I'm going to be nice.
First round, number three overall, Lamar Jackson went off the board. Thank you, sir. I can't hate on that pick too much. You know, I can't even hate on the Travis Kelce pick that much. Like, those two picks were good.
I can't hate on his backup quarterback getting Teddy Bridgewater with the last pick in the 16th round.
Yeah, it's kind of third last pick. It'll be interesting to see what Teddy Bridgewater does. But, yeah, to get him in the last round, I think was a good pick. But, to have George Kittle as your flex is interesting. You usually don't see a tight end in a flex spot.
No.
Hey, James, did you also draft two kickers too, or is that somebody else I'm thinking about? Was that you?
No, I think there was somebody else.
Yeah, just one.
It was Joe R. He drafted Lutz in round number 9 and then turned around and drafted Mason Crosby in the 15th round.
And I get no credit for drafting a Terp. None.
Nah, because he's not going to play.
It doesn't matter.
Yeah, that's like me getting clowned on for drafting Antonio Brown. It's the same thing, but I have better shot at Antonio Brown playing than your player. But anyways.
You in this draft that they're talking about, last year.
Yes.
You drafted Antonio Brown.
Yes. 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 In the 13th round.
Oh, was it? Okay. I thought it was a little higher than that, but still in the 13th round.
I'm so glad that I'm sitting where I'm sitting and the setup is the way it is tonight so that my facial reactions to some of the things are not...
Oh, we can wait a minute.
All the time. Because going back to a previous comment about a certain GM/head coach in the NFL, that may have gotten me in trouble within the league. I'm not going to name names. That may have given me some grief there, but that reaction.
Yeah.
Joe Carlozzo, by Yahoo's terms, had the best draft of everybody.
I didn't have the worst draft. Shout out to Joe.
No, yeah. according to Yahoo.
So to run down who he got, because they, you know, if you're going to say he had the best, who did he have, right? Drafted Saquon Barkley in the first round, Chris Godwin, Pat Mahomes, Evan Singletary, Marquise Brown, Gronk, Deebo Samuel, Kerryon Johnson, Henry Ruggs III, Christian Kirk, Bills defense, Matt Breida, Rashad Perriman, Joe Burrow, Justin Hooper, Chris Boswell. That was his draft.
That was the top.
According to Yahoo.
Yeah, 12 team half point PPR.
I might be with Yahoo on that. I mean, obviously not seeing the other 11 teams, but.
So we'll go down the list then.
That's solid.
So one of my keys to my draft was how I was going to keep Ryan from having success.
You did that with the first pick. That's why.
Yep.
Yeah. Well, no, it was really my third round pick that nailed, keeping him from his one terp that he would have wanted to draft in DJ Moore. All right. So here we'll run down mine as well. First pick again. This is the number 6th overall pick. I took a little bit of a flyer on a wild card because he's a rookie.
Yeah.
But I took Clyde Edwards-Helaire because I think he's going to have an immediate impact, especially with the running back depth that they don't have there now. I took Aaron Jones in the second round, so I got my two running backs there. DJ Moore and Cooper Kupp both are going to be good receivers and good receptions targets. I got David Montgomery out of Chicago. I know he's got a little bit of an injury right now, but I think he'd be a good flex play. I was able to get Kyler Murray, which I think he's going to take even another step having Hopkins out there.
Yeah.
I did take J.K. Dobbins because I think long-term, I think he'll have a good impact, especially later on in the year. Hayden Hurst and Noah Fant are my tight ends. I got Emmanuel Sanders as a backup running back. I got CeeDee Lamb, the rookie out of Dallas, which I think he'll have some big splash plays. I took old Mr. Reliable. He was sitting there on the board at like the 14th round, and Larry Fitzgerald. I think he'll still get a few targets later on. And then I got Jake Elliott and Baker Mayfield as my backup quarterback.
Emmanuel Sanders Chargers is a wide receiver.
Yeah, that's what I said.
Not a running back.
That's what I said.
You said running back.
Oh, my fault.
All right, so let's run down. So we're going to run down. We'll run down Brian's. So Brian got first round, first pick, Christian McCaffrey.
Slam dunk figure.
Leonard Fournette.
Trash.
Desperate running back at that point in time.
Yikes.
Mike Evans, A.J. Brown, Le'Veon Bell, Dak Prescott.
Bell and Fournette.
Marvin Jones, Jared Cook, Tevin Coleman.
Nicole Hardman.
Robbie Gould. Mike Williams, Tony Pollard, Anthony McFarland Jr., Drew Locke.
That was fun.
Took Ryan from his other trip that he might pick.
So James's full team, Lamar Jackson,
Stack.
Kelsey, Kittle, Hilton, Jonathan Taylor, A.J. Green, Ronald Jones, 49ers, Steelers.
That's so bad.
Sterling Shepard, Robbie Anderson, N'Keal Harry, Antonio Brown, Brian Hill, Josh Lambeau, Teddy Bridgewater.
What's your reaction?
It's a 12-team league.
Yeah.
And he's got Lamar.
Yeah.
He's going to be above 500. That I mean, if Lamar does
what
anything
did.
Near yeah. what he did last year, when at the end of the season in the playoffs, you started seeing those hashtag I survive Lamar. Anytime
right.
somebody actually mm-hmm. won a playoff game
playing
against Lamar Jackson.
Right.
If he was who he was last year, he will be a game changer in the fantasy game.
I agree with that. Ryan and I were talking about that too. There are only a couple of guys in the league that are like that.
But lots of other suspect picks in there.
Right.
Yeah, I mean,
the thing is, the reason why I got Lamar is I know on the way back he wasn't going to be there. So if I wanted my guy, I had to
get
him.
It was a serpentine draft, so I get it.
I'm not doubting your Lamar pick.
No, but
that was the good one.
No, if you were there, everybody knew I was going to probably pick him first, because
your two top wide receivers are T.Y. Hilton and A.J.
Okay.
Green.
And they have Rivers out there. That
is T.Y. Hilton even going to play this year?
Yeah.
Is A.J. Green even going to play this year?
Contract.
Is Rivers
contract
even going to stay healthy?
Man.
Here's my issue with it. In a 12-team league, there are quasi-professional fantasy football players, if that is such a thing, that in a league that's that thin, because you've got the 12 teams, depending
right.
obviously on the layout of the teams and the slots and everything, that don't even draft defense or kickers. They wait to pick them up on the waiver wire week to week.
We purposely, that is a rule in our league. Because if you're doing that, that's a professional thing, but that's not to me and to him, that is not a skill in drafting. Part of developing and working a fantasy team, in my opinion, is you got to pick the best at every position in the best spot that you can.
Fair. But when you only have to pick one, and many people would prefer to pick none, why pick two?
Oh, well, yeah, that I don't disagree.
That I don't disagree.
So, Ryan.
That's one, hold on. That's one that you cannot pick up
So you only play one a week.
Speaking
exactly,
of that,
but you can't have one of those.
Speaking of that, right?
Let's go the opposite end.
I got to talk Ryan here for a second.
And then we're going to get into mine.
He's tuned in. In his first eight picks, he filled two positions.
Yeah.
Four running backs followed by four wide receivers
in a row.
Now, listen, the players that he got, I'm not hating on it. He got good players. He got Delvin Cook. He got Nick Chubb. He got Melvin Gordon. He got James Conner. Last two. He got Allen Robinson, Michael Gallup, Will Fuller, and Darius Slayton.
He's going off in the chat room now.
I'm sure he is.
Speed talk. On
eight picks, and he took two positions. Now, granted, I know that's four spots on an a fantasy roster, potentially five if you're putting one, at a flex position. Yeah. But, man, all day long I was like, golly, are you going to draft a tight end? Are you going to draft a quarterback? Well, let's get to his quarterbacks. In round, what is this, 11? His quarterback, starting quarterback, was Daniel Jones, the second-year, I guess, guy out of for the Giants. So I gave him a bunch of shit for that. That's going to be his number one. So he followed that up. I think he panicked, and then he took Cam Newton behind him as his backup.
Not a starter yet.
Not a starter yet. That's right. He did get Tyler Higbee as a starting tight end, which isn't bad for where he got him. Then he got the Colts D, Alan Lazard, which was a good pick late as a wide receiver. Right. And then he got Young Ho Koo. You got Young Ho.
Yeah.
I mean, that's when you want him, right?
Yeah, exactly.
The best part of all this, Fred's in front and Ryan's in the back, and they're like, have like a lead together, and they're like, we're going to need to talk about this, Ryan, for our next draft.
Yeah, because we went in another league. It's a keeper league. We absorbed somebody else's shit team, literally the bottom-dwelling team. And so it's a keeper league. You got to keep three players. You can keep up to three players. And we got to turn this thing around quickly. And the way he was drafted in this, I'm like, man, we're going to have to sit down and talk strategy. Eight players, two positions, not going to fly with me, big guy.
So I was happy with my draft. I was actually very happy with my draft. So I got Derrick Henry, Tyreek Hill, Raheem Mostert, Calvin Ridley, Jordan Howard, Tyler Lockett, quarterbacks Drew Brees. I know you're giving him shit, but whatever.
Won me a title 2 years ago, him and Michael Thomas. That 1-2 combo was lethal two years ago.
And last year.
Hunter Henry, Tyler Boyd, Jerry Jeudy, TJ Hockenson, Boston Scott. I got the Bears defense. I got Matt Gay as my kicker, who's Tampa Bay, which you got to figure with everything they got down there, they're going to be somewhere in the red zone, right? Then my backup is Ryan Tannehill, and my last pick was Giovanni Bernard.
Yeah,
I was happy with it.
Yeah, I don't think you got a bad team.
It gave me like an average rating on everything I was looking at.
Yeah, the Yahoo stuff, it means absolutely nothing.
I use Football Guys. So that's what I was telling you before. So it looks at everybody's drafts. It looks at your previous history. Like, it's nice. It really ties in. Yeah. So I was able to look
at everybody's. Were you a fantasy guy before you got into the business? Or?
So there was a time through law school and everything where I was just too busy. And by the time I got everything together to the point where, hey, maybe I can start doing this, then I started pursuing being an agent, and technically it's betting on the NFL, I'm a sideline on it. But to the one theory, I mean, having, again, the strategies are different depending on how the league's set up. I mean, I've played back in the day in leagues that were as few as eight teams.
Right.
So the way that you're going to draft that team is a lot different. When you're 12 teams deep, taking four running backs and boxing out the rest of that league from those guys, that's part of a strategy.
I know.
You're not going to play all those guys necessarily every week, but guess what? You got them. Somebody else doesn't.
Right. But if you're going to do that and you're taking them with your first four picks and your last two are Melvin Gordon and James Conner, both of which have big question marks.
Conner's
going,
had a huge struggle last year.
Yeah, I mean, yeah. I
had him last year because he looked good the year before. Last year, you thought he was going to make that leap.
I feel like he could have upgraded his wide receiver position there at those two slots and then taken the same and gotten the same value out of Gordon and Conner later, because I just don't see them having much value this year.
You could have gone 2-2-2-2 instead of 4-4.
Right.
Especially when you can only start two running backs and then one flex.
Well, you could technically start three because of the flex.
I'm saying the flex. You can start two running backs and one flex.
Fred and Scott, real quick, Ryan's going off. Name one bad wide receiver on his team, please.
On his? Well, yeah. Will Fuller can't stay on the field. Now, listen, I know when he is on the field, he produces, and I get that, but he can't stay on the field. Michael Gallup, I don't think he's a bad wide receiver, but he still needs to prove himself a little bit, and he's got some company out there. He's got, you know,
Amari Cooper.
He's got Amari Cooper, and then he's got the young rookie out there.
CeeDee Lamb.
Coming in there, that's going to take some receptions away from him too. I'm not saying they're bad receivers. Allen Robinson, though, that's your number one. You can never trust a Bears wide receiver, in my opinion. Yeah. Who do they got throwing him the football? Mitch Trubisky? I mean, or they brought in Big Dick Nick, right?
Yeah.
So that guy, I mean, I don't know how much I trust in either one of those guys.
And Fred, he is a Penn State guy, so you're going against the Terps, so that's a negative right there already.
Yeah. Oh, man. But I love the fact that I was able to keep DJ Moore out of his hands.
Yeah. You did love that.
That satisfied the rest of the draft for me. I was happy.
But you two better get it figured out, because one of the guys you're going against in your other draft is Drew. And
Drew's going
off.
He's
got you two figured out.
Yeah, he was there.
Yeah.
He robbed me of $260 on the poker table.
Whoa.
Whoa, hold on here.
Or however much it was.
I'm pretty sure you did it to yourself.
I did. I was let me just set the precedence here, right?
Uh-oh.
Here you're the only one that only put $20 in.
Yeah, it was $20 buy-in. I only bought in one time, the original opening buy-in. And I'm telling you, I was 10-1. Everybody if it was a 3.5 hour game for 3 hours and 15 minutes, I was 10-1 everybody else chips.
Right, because I wasn't playing.
Go to my camp for a second. I'm gonna show everybody.
It's because I wasn't playing, by the way, because I'd have whooped all your asses, just saying.
So it might be hard to see.
Oh man.
Oh good God. Zoom in. Here, why don't you come to my cam?
No, I got it. There we go.
Oh Jesus. That's one sexy bitch right there.
There it is.
Look at those chips.
Look at that, tons of fun. I like it.
Go a little lower there, Scott.
I mean, I was dominating. I had more black chips, which were the $500 chips, than most people had in just regular chips.
And racist.
That's how it was. I'm not even going there. But in a matter of 15 minutes, my anxiety went up. I started thinking about the draft and all this stuff, and I just started making stupid bets. And then I realized, oh, fuck, I'm about to lose everything that I've got. And then as soon as I did, I'm like, oh, fuck, I got to start playing smart. They all started being a bunch of bitches and just started folding every hand and folding every hand
because
until the clock ran.
We had a time limit on it.
Yeah. What were you doing? Bastards. Like going all in every hand? Is that
pretty
what you
much,
were doing? Okay.
I'm
following you.
He was calling, and the stuff that he was calling with usually wasn't bad.
What,
but
do you have like pair of deuces or something like that? That's what
I had a horseshoe up my ass because I'm not very good at cards, but I had a horseshoe up my ass for a long time, and then
yeah,
I don't
you
know,
fucking did. It you just took my ass out with a horseshoe.
It fell right out.
He took me out.
Get your
ring
between
river.
The teeth, and then it all fell out.
You took my ass out with a full house on the fucking river.
Yeah.
I was
oh
pissed.
Shit, that's hard.
I'd have had him if it wasn't for that.
I got quads for the first time in my life.
See,
quads.
I love playing that.
Four jokers.
But
four
jacks.
But unfortunately, I had to work, so the professional couldn't show up and school you
right
now.
Right.
<can't.
laughs>
Well, when, don't worry. We're gonna have another game soon.
Oh, damn.
When do you guys play these games?
So this was the first time we played, but we'll definitely send you an invite the next time we play. Ryan just moved in like 10 minutes away from here, so
Joe was over there like, I'm gonna make some money on this.
You definitely would make money off us.
I have WSOP caches on my resume. So
I like this guy.
All right. Well, we appreciate everybody tuning in. We'll see you guys next week. 7:30 as usual. We'll see you guys.